Random House Audiobooks presents Dragonlance Chronicles, Volume 2, Dragons of Winter Night, by Margaret Weiss and Tracy Hickman. Read for you by Peter MacNicol.
The dragon named Sky flexed his huge wings and lifted his ponderous body from the hot spring. He stamped his clawed feet irritably, sending huge rocks tumbling down the icy mountain. Winter was not for blue dragons, he thought, nor was this abysmal country. He looked for his human master and found her standing on a rock ledge, gazing down at the plains below.
Come, return to your tent, lord. This wind cuts to the bone,
the dragon complained.
Why are we here anyway? This land is under the command of the Red Dragons. Our war is in the north, not here. We're losing valuable time.
The High Lord's cape swirled around her blue dragon scale armor. We're here because my spies tell me they are here, or will be shortly. They killed Verminard. Now they must pay. The dragon snorted.
Verminard was an obsessed fool.
Verminard, the High Lord countered icily, knew what damage knowledge of the true gods can do us. Now the people have a cleric of Paladine, this Elistan. Worshippers of Mishikal bring true healing to the land. The elves have joined with dwarves and humans to destroy us. There's great danger here. Again the dragon snorted.
This priest Elistan travels to Tarsus. By tonight he'll be ours.
The High Lord shrugged. Elistan is not the one I seek. Sky raised his head, startled.
No? Who, then?
There are three in whom I have particular interest. I'll provide you with descriptions. It is to capture them that we participate in the destruction of Tarsus tomorrow. Tanis, half-elven, glanced around to make certain no one was lagging behind. The companion's line stretched out single file across the sunny, snow-covered plains of dust, the heavier travelers clearing the way for the smaller ones behind them. At Tanis's side was Sturm Brightblade, the steadfast knight of Salamnia, who insisted on traveling in his full antique battle armor. Behind Sturm and Tanis trudged Caramon, the great bear of a warrior, his arsenal of weapons clanking around him. He carried his own supplies and those of his twin brother, Raceland. Next came Gilfanus, the magic-using Qualanesti elf-lord. He and Tanis had been raised as brothers, though a gulf separated them now. For while Gilfanus was born a prince, Tanis was the product of the brutal rape of his elven mother by a human warrior. Worse, when the two were growing up, the half-elf had fallen in love with Gilfanus' sister, the golden-haired Lorana. Gilfanus and Tanis had exchanged bitter words over this, and because of it, Tanis had left Qualanesti. They traveled together now only because of the war. Armies of draconian lizardmen, led by evil high lords who rode on the backs of dragons, were on the verge of subjugating all the races of Kryn. Behind Gilfanus came Goldmoon, the barbarian princess, who had become a cleric of Mishikal, goddess of healing. Beside Goldmoon walked Riverwind, her bodyguard, and since autumn, her husband. They were the only members of the Quaishu tribe to survive the draconian onslaught, but despite their grief, the flame of love burned brightly in the newlyweds' hearts. Next came Elistan, cleric of Paladine, the great god of good. Elistan walked with Lorana, who had become instrumental in helping him serve the needs of the 800 refugees recently freed from Verminard's hold at Pax Tharkas. The beautiful elf princess had run away from her homeland of Qualanesti, following Tanis. Since then, she'd been forced to grow up rapidly, her eyes open to the pain and suffering of war. Tanis smiled back at Lorana, but she seemed not to notice him. He let out a sigh, remembering the fight they'd had before they set out on this journey. Lorana was jealous of Tanis's love for Kitiara, the half-sister of Caramon and Raceland. Lorana had even accused Tanis of growing his reddish-brown beard to hide his elven heritage. That accusation had stung him, But what hurt even more was his love for Lorana, which had grown tremendously during their adventures at Pax Darkus. To Tanis, Kitiar was becoming a distant memory. Yet, by returning the ring Lorana had given him, Tanis sensed he'd hurt her too deeply to ever make amends. Next to Lorana walked Tika, the barmaid turned adventuress. After her hometown of Solace had been destroyed by Verminard and his hordes, the pretty redhead had joined the companions to fight the great evil overtaking Kryn. Tika walked beside Caramon's brother, Raislin, a frail mage with golden eyes and hourglass pupils that looked into the future. Raislin had willingly traded in his physical health for mystical powers when he took the wizard's tests at the Tower of High Sorcery. Now he stumbled along, the ancient spellbook of Fiston Dantalus in hand, struggling to master the spells it revealed. Trudging through the snow behind Tika and Raislin was the ancient hill dwarf, Flint Fireforge. It was only after Caramon had pulled Flint out of three snowdrifts that Tanis' old friend had grudgingly agreed to walk, as he put it, rear guard. Skipping along beside Flint was the Kender, Tasselhoff Burfoot, humming a merry tune in his piping voice. Tanis had already reprimanded the little Kender for hitting Sturm in the head with a snowball, but he knew it was useless. Kender were a race considered by many on Kryn to be a nuisance, especially since they had a penchant for acquiring other people's property. Kender were unable to experience fear. They lived for new adventures. Unlike the others, Tanis thought, Tass was enjoying every minute of this arduous journey. Yes, they were all there. They were all following him. Tanis turned around abruptly, facing south. I hardly know where my life is going, he thought. Yet I'm expected to lead others? The companions had accomplished much. They had killed the Dragon High Lord, Verminard, and freed 800 slaves he held at Pax Darkus. They had found the refugees a temporary home in Thorbarden, the underground kingdom of the Mountain Dwarves. But the price they'd had to pay for that refuge was heavy. They'd given the dwarves the legendary hammer of Karas. According to legend, the hammer had been used to forge the Dragonlances, which alone could defeat the evil dragons. Now, the companions traveled south to the fabled port city of Tarsus. There, they would book passage on a ship to search for a part of Kryn, untouched by war, where the refugees might have a permanent home. Tanis's boots crunched determinedly through the crusty snow. The journey was difficult, he thought, as it had been since they'd first left Solace. Still, they'd found signs of hope. The companions had rescued the disks of Mishakal from the clutches of dragons, and in the disks, they'd found the history of the true forgotten gods. Elistan and Goldmoon had become the first clerics of the true gods since before the Cataclysm, 350 years earlier. Sturm nudged Tanis, pointing at a line of small hills ahead of them.
If Tarsus' map is correct, Tanis, Tarsus lies beyond.
Tanis raised his hand as a signal to halt, then spread out the map.
We'll make camp here at the base of the hills. I'll climb, though, to get a look at the city.
Ready to start, he felt Raceland's cold hand on his shoulder.
I will come with you. My brother will help me.
Tanis regarded the mage uneasily, but Raceland's face was impassive and cold. Very well, the half-elf told him. But when they reached the top of the hill overlooking the legendary seaport, Tanis stared down in bitter disappointment.
The Kenda's map. It must be dated from before the Cataclysm. The sea is dry. Tarsus is landlocked.
Raceland looked over at him.
What do we do with the refugees now, half-elf?
I don't know, but it's no good standing here. The sea isn't going to return. We can't just go back to Thorbarden. Perhaps we could journey to the headquarters of the Knights of Salamnia at Sancrist. For the moment, though, we'd better go into town and see what's happening.
Caramon glanced around nervously.
I feel eyes watching us, even now.
You are wise to trust your feelings, my brother, Raceland said softly. Great danger and great evil surround us.
350 years earlier, Tarsus the Beautiful had been Lord City of the lands of Abinacinia. The knights of Salamnia guarded the land, living their disciplined lives in strict observance of the code and the measure. The knights were pious followers of Paladine. The people, however, worshipped the king-priest of Istar, who in his arrogance presumed to make demands of the gods. In time, even the knights fell under the sway of the mighty king-priest. Then came the cataclysm, a night of terror, when the skies rained fire. The ground heaved and cracked as the gods in their righteous anger hurled a mountain of rock down upon Kryn. When the night of horror ended, Tarsus was landlocked. The people turned to the knights for help, but they could do nothing. The knights returned to Salamnia, and gradually Tarsus lost touch with the outside world. No longer did sailors walk the marketplace. Elves, dwarves, and other races came no more. The people of Tarsus began to mistrust the outside world. Strangers were feared, and the knights of Salamnia were loathed. None of the knights had been seen in the city for at least 100 years. After a night of fitful sleep, the companions woke at sunrise and entered the city. At the outer walls, a wary-eyed guard directed them to an inn called the Red Dragon. After they'd eaten, they settled in and began poring over their maps. Flint shoved his empty plate away and wiped his hand across his mouth.
That is what comes of trusting a tender's map. Leads us to a seaport with no sea.
Tanis sighed. We just let our hopes get too high. Tasselhoff, feeling mollified, rolled up his map. He was growing bored. While the others argued about whether to return to Thorbarden or keep searching for a seaport, the Kender slipped away to explore the city. Soon, though, he burst back through the door. Guards, Tanis! Coming this way! Everyone hushed. They heard the tramp of soldiers coming in their direction. Tanis rose to his feet. Goldmoon, Tika, Loran, and Elistan go upstairs. Riverwind, Caramon, Raislin, you stay and protect them. Sturm, Gilthanas, and Tasselhoff will remain with me. Flint?
I stay with you, Tanis.
The dwarf stated firmly. Flint pulled his battle axe out of its holder on his back and handed it to Caramon.
Better you get this than any lice-ridden guards.
Good idea, Tanis agreed. He handed Caramon, Wormslayer, the magical sword given to him by the skeleton of Kit Kanan, the ancient elven king. Gilthanas handed over his sword and bow.
Yours too, knight,
Caramon said, holding out his hand. Sturm frowned. His antique, two-handed sword and its scabbard were the only legacy he had of his father. Seeing the knight's concern, Caramon grew solemn.
I'll guard it carefully, Sturm.
Raceland's thin lips curled into a smile. His hourglass eyes gleamed.
Do not fear, knight. Your weapon is safe, as are the lives of those you leave in our care. But a long farewell it will be. Some of us are not destined to meet again in this world.
He gathered his red robes and began to climb the stairs. Trust Raceman to exit with a flourish, Tanis thought irritably. Go on, he ordered. If he's right, there's nothing we can do about it now. After a hesitant look at Tanis, everyone did as he said. Caramon waited behind until the others had gone upstairs. Then he called to Tanis.
If you're not back by nightfall?
The half-elf was more disturbed than he cared to admit. Then get the others back to Thorbarden. Caramon nodded and walked up the stairs, his weapons clanking around him.
As soon as Caramon had gone upstairs, the guards arrested Tanis, Sturm, Gilthanas, Flint, and Tasselhoff on suspicion of spying for the hated knights of Salamnia. Then the soldiers tried to go upstairs and round up the others, but Raistlin used his magic to stop them, and the guards had to give up on that idea. As he was led away from the inn, Tanis stared up at Lorana's window, aching with love for her. He longed to give Lorana some sort of sign, let her know he'd been a fool, but the curtain on her window was drawn. As they were marched through the streets, the citizens, seeing the Salamnic rosette on Sturm's breastplate, started a riot, pelting him and the others with stones and rotting vegetables. In the confusion, Tasselhoff managed to get away.
What is the charge against these men?
The Lord of Tarsus asked from his seat in the council chamber. The constable gave the companions a baleful glance.
Inciting a riot, my lord, and suspicion of spying.
Just then the doors banged open, and two guards strode in, roughly dragging a woman prisoner. Heavily veiled, she dropped to the floor as if too tired or defeated to rise. Then, seeming to make a supreme effort of will, she started to push herself up. Obviously, no one was going to assist her. Sturm watched in horror, appalled at this callous treatment of a woman. "Kill me if you will, but I am going to the aid of the lady." Tanis held his breath. The guard stepped back, looking up at the lord for orders, but the lord only shook his head slightly. "My lady, allow me to assist you," Sturm said with the courtly, old-fashioned politeness long lost in the world.
"You'd better leave me, Sir Knight."
At the sound of the woman's voice, Tanis and Gilthanas gasped softly.
"She's Sylvanus the Elven,"
Gilthanas whispered to Tanis.
"What could she be doing here?
The Sylvanesti never mingle with humans." Gilthanas fell silent just as the lord started to speak.
"Lady Alhanna, I was merciful last time you came before me because you said you were on a diplomatic mission from your people. I gave you 24 hours to depart. Now I find you still here."
He looked at the constable.
"What is the charge?" "Trying to buy mercenaries, my lord. Of course no one in Tarsus would aid an elf. It would violate our understanding with the dragon armies."
"Silence!"
the lord bellowed.
"Those are secret matters, not for the ears of strangers."
But the companions had heard what they had heard, and they were filled with dread.
The draconians had gotten there before them.
At the same time, something else was bothering Tanis.
"Alhanna," he said to Gilthanas, "why is that name familiar?"
"Have you been gone from your people so long you don't recognize the name of Alhanna Starbreeze, daughter and sole heir of the Speaker of the Stars?"
"Alhanna," Tanis said, memories coming back to him.
The Qualanesti and Sylvanesti elves had split from each other hundreds of years before, during the bitter Kinslayer Wars. Alhanna was the princess of the Sylvanesti. Of all elf maidens, she was reputed to be the most beautiful. But she was as distant as the silver moon that shone on her birth.
"Lady Alhanna,"
the lord said,
"you are under arrest."
Sturm stepped nearer to the woman, casting the guards a warning glance.
"Hold, knight,"
the lord commanded.
"I will not have blood shed in this council chamber. Guards, escort the lady to prison, but do so with the same courtesy you show me. And you, Sir Knight, will accompany her, since you are so interested in her welfare. Take them all away."
As the guards closed in, Alhanna appeared to hunt for something within the folds of her skirt.
"I beg a favor, Sir Knight. I seem to have dropped something."
Sturm knelt swiftly and immediately saw the object where it lay, sparkling on the floor, hidden by the folds of her dress. It was a pin, shaped like a star, glittering with diamonds. No wonder she did not want it found by these worthless guards. Quickly he wrapped his fingers around it, then feigned to look about. Finally he looked up at the woman, catching his breath as she removed her hood and drew the veil from her face. For the first time, human eyes gazed upon the face of Alhanna Starbreeze, Princess of the Night. Her hair was black and soft as the night wind, her eyes with the deep purple of the night sky, and her lips the color of the red moon's shadows. The knight's first thought was to give thanks to Paladine that he was already on his knees. His second was that death would be a paltry price to pay to serve her.
"Thank you for searching, noble knight," Alhanna said softly, staring into Sturm's eyes. "It was but a trifle. Please rise. I am weary, and you could do me a great favor by assisting me."
Sturm rose, deftly tucking the jewel into his belt. "I am yours to command." Alhanna put her hand on his trembling forearm. Tanis saw Alhanna's beauty enter the knight's heart, doing more damage than a goblin's poisoned arrow tip. The Sylvanesti were a haughty race. Fearing the loss of their way of life, they had long refused to have even the slightest contact with humans. The Silver Moon itself was not farther out of Sturm's reach. As the prisoners were led from the Hall of Justice, two pairs of evil eyes watched with interest. They were Draconians, the dreaded lizard men who served the evil dragons and worshipped the Queen of Darkness.
They match the description,
one Draconian told the other as he pulled him away.
We must report this to the High Lord at once. Let's go.
This time, to avoid a riot, the constable led his prisoners away through an alley behind the Hall of Justice. There, three men fell upon the guards and rescued Tanis and the others. They were knights of Salamnia. Tasselhoff had found them and brought them to rescue his friends. The knights were led by Derek Crowngard, and their mission was to find any information they could about dragons. Tasselhoff, it seems, had stolen a pair of magical glasses from the mountain dwarves of Thorbarden. With these glasses of true seeing, the Kender could read any language. He was able to decipher the ancient writings in the Library of Tarsus. These writings told of dragon orbs, magical glass spheres made by the mages of long ago that could be used to control dragons. But before Tass could read further, they heard the horns of the attacking dragon armies, the horns of death. The knights planned to leave the city immediately and report back to their headquarters in Sandcrest, where the Knights of Salamnia were soon to hold a Council of Whitestone, a great congress of all the races to coordinate resistance to the dragon armies. Derek ordered Sturm and Tasselhoff to come with them, but Sturm refused. His first loyalties were to his friends. Derek, furious, swore vengeance as he departed. He revealed to the companions that Sturm was not yet a full-fledged Knight of Salamnia, and that when the question of Sturm's knighthood came before the Council of Whitestone, Derek intended to vote against him. With that, he left the astonished companions. There was no time to question Sturm about this news, however. Tarsus was under attack. They made haste to rejoin their friends at the inn, but on the way the companions became separated. Sturm and Alhanna found themselves under attack by red dragons who were melting buildings everywhere and reducing people to piles of ashes with their fiery blasts. Alhanna found herself overcome with tenderness for this strong emotional human. But she saw this fondness as weakness in herself, and decided that they must part. She gave Sturm the Star Jewel to keep, telling him she would always think of him. She sent him on his way, assuring him that friends were coming for her to take her from the burning city. Meanwhile, Tanis and a wounded Gilthanas neared the inn, only to find it surrounded by Draconians. Tanis left Gilthanas hidden in a doorway and sneaked around back to the inn's kitchen. On the way, he found Flint leaning over a severely injured Tasselhoff. A beam had fallen on the Kender, pinning him. Tanis ran for the inn, meaning to rescue its occupants and get help for Tass and Gilthanas. Just as he got inside the inn, however, it was attacked by a huge red dragon, and it was too late to take cover.
There was a screaming whine and a boom. The inn shook as if it were made of sticks. The air exploded with debris. Flames erupted. Above them, they could hear the sound of wood splitting and breaking. Get out, Tanis shouted. The whole place is... The beam above him cracked. Gripping Lorana, he flung her as far from him as he could and saw Elistan catch her in his arms. As the huge beam above Tanis gave way with a snap, he heard the mage shriek strange words. Then he was falling, falling into blackness, and it seemed that the world fell on top of him. At that moment, Sturm rounded a corner to see the inn of the Red Dragon collapse in a cloud of flame and smoke. A dragon soared in the sky above it. Sturm ducked into a doorway, hiding in the shadows as some Draconians passed him, laughing and talking in their cold, guttural language. Three others, he noticed, dressed in blue uniforms, not red, appeared upset at the inn's destruction, shaking their fists at the red dragon overhead. Sturm sagged against the door. Then his heart gave a painful bound. He saw a flash of white. Elistan, he cried, watching the cleric of Paladine emerge from the rubble, dragging Lorana with him. The Draconians ran toward them, calling out for them to surrender. Sturm yelled the challenge of a Salamnic knight to an enemy and ran out from his doorway. The Draconians whirled about, surprised to see the knight. Stern became dimly aware that another figure was running with him. Glancing to his side, he saw the flash of a metal helm and heard Flint roar a dwarven battle cry. Then from a doorway, he heard words of magic. Gilfanus had crawled out of the alley where Tanis had left him and was pointing at the Draconians, reciting a spell. Flaming darts leaped from his hands. One of the creatures fell over, clutching its burning chest. Flint sprang at another, beating it over the head with a rock, while Sturm felled a third with a blow from his fists. "Sturm," Lorana said, pointing behind her. "Your sword, it's here. I saw it." Sure enough, Sturm saw a flash of silver, barely visible beneath the rubble. His sword, and next to it was Tanis's, the elven blade of Kithcanin. Lifting the two swords, Sturm listened for movement. There was only silence. "We've got to get out of here," he said, looking at the wreckage. "The others?"
"They were all in there," Elistan said in a trembling voice. "The half-elf came in just before the dragon hit the inn."
"I don't believe it,"
Flint said fiercely, leaping into the rubble. Sturm yanked him back.
"Where's Tass?"
the knight said sternly. The dwarf's face fell.
"Pinned under a beam. I've got to go back to him, but I can't leave him."
The dwarf began to cry.
"Garamond, that big dumb ox. I need him. He can't do this to me. And Tanis, too."
Sturm put his hand on Flint's shoulder.
"Go back to Tass. He needs you now."
"Tanis! Tanis!" Lorana screamed, a terrifying, pitiful sound that pierced Sturm like a spear. She fell onto her hands and knees, trying to lift the blackened stones. Sturm watched heartsick, uncertain what to do. Then he had his answer. More horns, and they were coming nearer. The armies were invading. He looked at Elistan, who nodded in sad understanding. Elistan knelt down beside her.
"Tanis gave his life for you, Lorana. We must escape now and keep fighting these monsters."
Lorana stared up at him. Elistan was right. Though she would rather lie down and die, she must go on. That was what Tanis would do.
"Farewell, Tantalus," she whispered.
Rain was beginning to pour down gently through the ash-filled air, as if the gods themselves wept for Tarsus the Beautiful. Water dripped on Raistlin's head. It was irritating, cold. He tried to roll over, but there was a heavy weight pressing down on him. A body. Caramon. Using all his strength, Raistlin crawled out from under him. The mage located his brother's neck and felt for the light beat. It was strong. Raistlin lay back in relief, staring into the total darkness, and tried to remember. He'd cast a spell, created around him and those near him a force capable of shielding them from physical objects. He remembered the building collapsing and a falling sensation. Falling. Ah, Raistlin understood. He must have crashed through the floor into the cellar. Groping around, he found the staff of Magius. Its crystal was unbroken. Only dragonfire could damage the staff, which had been given to him by the wizard Par Salian in the Towers of High Sorcery.
"Shirak,"
he now whispered. The staff flared into light at Raistlin's command. There were Tanis, Riverwind, Goldmoon, and Tika, all huddled near Caramon. Raistlin smiled. A nice bit of work, that spell. Once more they were in his debt.
"Tanis, you're safe," he whispered, coughing. "Wake up."
Tanis sat bolt upright.
"We're in the cellar," the mage said. "The floor gave in and dropped us down."
Beneath the ruins of the inn, the companions took stock of their situation. Goldmoon treated their injuries, which were not serious, thanks to Raistlin's spell. But they had no idea how they could escape.
"We're behind enemy lines," Caramon said. "The armies of Draconians occupy the town, probably the land for miles around. There's no way out and nowhere to go if there were a way out."
As if to emphasize his words, the companions heard guttural voices above them.
"There's no one alive in this mess,"
whined a goblin voice.
"Tell that to the High Lord, you miserable dog-eaters,"
snarled a Draconian.
"Now dig, all of you."
The companions stared at each other in silent terror.
"What are we looking for?"
croaked a goblin.
"Silver? Jewels?"
"No," said another goblin.
"Spies or some such, wanted personally by the Dragon High Lord."
The sounds of digging grew louder. It would only be minutes now before they were discovered. Then suddenly, there were new sounds. There was a scream, draconian, and a clear, high-pitched call like that of an eagle. Then a rending sound, and more screams from the draconians.
What is that?
Kiramon asked, his eyes wide.
It isn't a dragon. It sounds like some gigantic bird of prey.
It's tearing the draconians to shreds, Goldmoon said in awe as they listened. The screaming sound stopped abruptly. What new evil replaced the old? Then came the sound of mortar and timber being lifted away. Whatever was up there was intent on reaching them. Suddenly they scrambled for cover as a huge clawed foot plunged through the debris. Then the foot withdrew, leaving a wide gaping hole. A dark figure appeared above them, silhouetted against the burning sky. Behind it, they could make out the head of a gigantic lion-headed eagle. The companions shrank back, but it was too late. The figure had seen them. It knelt down near the hole and removed the hood covering its head.
We meet again, Tanis Half-Elven, said a voice as cool and distant as the stars.
Your thanks are not necessary, or even wanted, Alhanna Starbreeze said, as the companions flew through the rain on the backs of three griffins. I rescued you for my own purposes. I need warriors to help me find my father in Sylvanesti. Tanis gasped. But we must find our friends. If we can lay hands on those dragon orbs, we have a chance to end this war. Then we can go to Sylvanesti. We are going to Sylvanesti now. My griffins obey my command and mine alone. Besides, there is an orb in Sylvanesti. Tanis blinked at the stunning revelation. Then he thought of his friend. Where's Sturm? I don't know. He was going to the inn to find you. Why didn't you let him come with you if you needed warriors? Alhanna turned her back to Tanis. That is none of your concern. Then Caramon shouted,
Dragons! Blue dragons following us!
Tanis could never afterward clearly remember the nightmare flight from Tarsus. The only thing he remembered vividly occurred on the second night of their journey, as they huddled around a fire in a small cave. He was telling the others about the Kender's discovery in the library at Tarsus. At the mention of the dragon orbs, Raistlin's eyes glittered.
Dragon orbs, he repeated softly.
The mage's golden eyes stared at Alhanna.
You said there is a dragon orb in Sylvanesti?
Alhanna turned a pale face to the firelight.
We keep it as a relic of bygone days. Who believed humans would once again wake this evil and bring the dragons back to Kryn?
Riverwind spoke angrily.
You have no proof it was humans.
Raistlin, Tanis interrupted. Tell us about the dragon orbs.
As Raistlin spoke, his voice changed, as if someone else was speaking through him. The voice told how the five dragon orbs were made by the great wizards of old, the white-robed mages who followed the good, the red-robed who were neutral, and the black-robed of evil. The orbs, once created, helped to rid the world of the Queen of Darkness and her legions of evil dragons. Then, in the days when the mages were banished by the king-priest of Istar, two of the orbs were destroyed. Knowledge of the other three had died with the great wizards. The orbs might still be used to control dragons, but only by mages of great power. Anyone else who tried would become the orb's prisoner. When she heard this, Alhanna was alarmed, believing her father Lorak had tried to keep the dragons from Sylvanesti by using the orb. After Raistlin's trance had passed, she pressed him for more information, but it was no use. He could remember nothing. Alhanna rushed from the cave, distracted. Tanis followed her outside.
The red moon had set, and the silver moon had risen. Its moonbeams grazed Alhanna with a beauty that took Tanis's breath away. Alhanna, Raistlin said something about a third moon, a black moon. I've never heard of a third moon. What do you know about it?
According to legend, it gives the black robes their power, but only they know its name or how to find it in the sky.
Tanis scratched his beard. How did your father get the orb?
My father, like Raistlin, took the tests at the Tower of High Sorcery. That's where he first saw the dragon orb. He said that during the tests, the orb spoke to his mind. You must not leave me here in Istar, it told him. If so, I will perish
and the world will be lost. My father took the orb.
But surely your father knew something about how to use it.
Alhanna drew her silvery scarf over her head. If so, he did not say. And now I must rest. Good night.
Good night, Lady Alhanna.
And don't worry. Your father has lived through much. I'm certain everything is all right. Alhanna started to sweep past without a word. Then, hearing the sympathy in his voice, she hesitated.
You are worried about your friends. Do not be. They escaped the city and are safe. Though the Kenda was close to death for a time, he survived. And now they travel to Icewall in search of a dragon orb.
How do you know this?
Blushing, Alhanna murmured.
I gave the knight a star jewel. He does not know its power, of course, nor how to use it. But he was so gallant, so brave. He helped me because I was in trouble, and he wept when the dragons killed the people. When the dragons drove us from our home, we elves did not weep. I think, perhaps, we've forgotten how.
Then, as if realizing she had said too much, she hastily entered the cave.
In the name of the gods,
Tanis breathed.
A star jewel. A gift exchanged by elven lovers forced apart. The jewel creates a bond between them. Thus linked, they share the innermost emotions of the loved one and can grant strength to each other in times of need. Never before had the half-elf heard of a star jewel being given to a human. What would it do to the man who received it?
Tanis's heart expanded with relief to know Lorana and the others were safe, but it contracted with fear for Sturm.
The stories, Tanis asked Alhanna 3 days later as they neared Sylvanesti. Humans trapped by the beauty of Sylvanesti, unable to leave? Do my friends dare enter this land?
The princess shot Tanis an icy look.
If I thought there was danger, I would not allow you to come.
The companions had just reached the river that separated Sylvanesti from the rest of Kryn. The tall Tower of the Stars had just come into view when the griffin suddenly halted the flight.
Keep going, Alhanna shouted. We must reach the tower.
But the griffin circled lower, ignoring her. Tanis didn't like it. The griffins were obviously afraid, and there was little they feared. They landed on the riverbank, moodily preening themselves and refusing to obey. Finally, the companions climbed off their backs and unloaded their supplies. Then the bird-lion creatures spread their wings and soared away. Alhanna ignored the angry glances she felt cast at her.
We shall simply have to walk, that's all. The way is not far.
The companions stared across the sparkling water into the forest beyond. All they saw were the aspen trees, glistening in the last lingering rays of sunset.
If this land is under the control of dragons, I'm a gully dwarf,
Caramon snorted.
Tanis, Alhanna said suddenly, putting her hand on his arm. Maybe my father defeated the lizard men. We've got to cross the river and find out. The ferry landing's down around the bend. Alhanna, wait,
Tanis called, but she was already running along the smooth grassy bank, her long full skirts fluttering around her ankles.
Alhanna!
Damn it, Caramon and Riverwind go after her. Goldmoon tried to talk some sense into her. Riverwind and Caramon exchanged uneasy glances, but they did as Tanis ordered, running along the riverbank after Alhanna. Goldmoon and Tika followed.
Who knows what's in these woods, Tanis muttered.
Bracelet?
It is as if there is an impenetrable fog in my head,
Bracelet whispered.
I see nothing, sense nothing.
Tanis stared at them intently, suddenly aware that Raistlin was lying.
But why?
If you see danger, tell us, Raistlin. We could at least enter prepared.
Then prepare, half-elf. Prepare.
They stepped out of the boat onto the opposite bank just as twilight vanished. Night seemed to swallow them.
Raistlin, your staff!
Tanis's voice echoed too loudly through the silent forest. Even Caramon cringed.
Shack.
The crystal globe flared in the light.
We must enter the woods,
Raistlin said in a shaky voice. No one else spoke or moved. They stood on the bank, fear overtaking them. There was no reason for it, and it was all the more frightening because it was illogical. Fear of what? There was nothing, nothing there.
Follow Raceland, his teeth chattering, Tanis staggered forward. Behind him, he could hear Tika whimper and Goldmoon trying to pray. He heard Caramon shout for his brother to stop and Riverwind cry out in terror. Desperately, Tanis stumbled after the mage. But when Tanis reached the trees, his strength failed him. He sank to his knees, then pitched forward, his hands clutching at the ground.
Raceland!
His throat was torn by a ragged scream, but the mage could not help him now. The last thing Tanis saw was the light from Raceland's staff, falling slowly to the ground, slowly and more slowly, released by the young mage's limp, seemingly lifeless hand.
The trees, the beautiful trees of Sylvanesti, trees fashioned and coaxed through centuries into groves of wonder. All around Tanis were the trees, but they were hideously changed. The soul of every tree around him appeared trapped in torment. The twisted branches were contorted in agony. The rustling of their leaves were cries of pain and terror. Tanis had no idea where he was or how long he had been here. He had begun walking toward the Tower of the Stars, which he could see rising above the branches of the aspens. He had walked and walked. Then he'd heard the Kender shriek in terror. Turning, he saw Tasselhoff pointing at the trees. Tanis only later understood that Tasselhoff wasn't supposed to be here. And there was Sturm, ashen with fear, and Lorana weeping in despair, and Flint, his eyes wide and staring. Tanis embraced Lorana, and his arms encompassed flesh and blood, but still he knew she was not there, even as he held her, and the knowledge was terrifying. Then the horror increased. Hungry animals bounded out from among the tormented trees and fell upon the companions. Tanis drew his sword to strike back, but the weapon shook in his trembling hand. The animals had been twisted and misshapen into hideous aspects of undying death. Riding among the misshapen beasts were legions of elven warriors, their skull-like features hideous to behold. No eyes glittered in the hollow sockets of their faces. Caramon, battling a wolf with snakes growing out of its body, looked up to see one of the elven warriors bearing down on him. He screamed to his brother for help. Askiran Kerir Satharan! A ball of flame flashed from the mage's hands to burst directly upon the elf. Without effect. Its spear pierced Caramon's armor, and the warrior slumped to the ground, bleeding. Goldmoon knelt to heal him, but stumbled over her prayers, her faith failing amid the horror. Help me, Mishikal, she prayed. Though blood still trickled down Caramon's arm, death loosed its grip on the warrior. Raceland knelt beside his brother and started to speak to him. Then, suddenly, the mage fell silent. He stared past Caramon into the trees.
You!
Caramon struggled to lift his head.
Who is it?
Raceland did not answer his brother.
Yes! Our bargain remains, but now you ask for more?
The mage asked his unseen visitor.
Name it. I accept.
Caramon cried out in horror as Raceland's robes deepened from red to maroon, then black.
But I accept with the understanding that the future can be changed. What must we do to get through to the tower alive?
Once more he attended carefully, then nodded.
Farewell, then, if such a thing is possible for you on your dark journey.
The mage rose to his feet, his black robes rustling around him.
Come around me,
he commanded his companions. He raised his hand, and the elven warriors stopped as though crashing against an unseen wall. The companions were astonished to hear Raceland speak in a new, strong voice.
Hurry! I cannot hold them back long!
One by one, the companions came forward, except for Sturm, who stood outside the circle.
I will die before I place myself under your protection, Raceland.
With that, Sturm turned and walked deeper into the forest. Tanis started after him, but stopped when he felt a strong hand grip his arm.
Let him go, the maid said sternly, or we are all lost.
We must make our way through this forest to the Tower of the Stars.
Every hideous creature ever conceived in the twisted, tortured dreams of mortals would arise to stop us.
But know this. we walk in a dream. The nightmare of the Speaker of the Stars, and our own nightmares as well. Our bodies are awake, but our minds sleep. Remember, death exists only in our minds, unless we believe otherwise. When you are firmly convinced that this is a dream, you will return to reality. If not, you will die. Ignoring the horrified stares of his companions, Raistlin turned to Caramon.
Lean on me, my brother.
For the first time in his life, the massive warrior leaned on Raistlin as they walked through the hideous forest.
Why do you wear the black robes now, Raist?
Caramon asked, choking.
What's happening? Save your breath, my brother.
The two traveled deeper into the forest, and the undead elven warriors stared menacingly at them from the trees. But none dared attack the black-robed mage. Tanis hurried through the forest, searching for Sturm. He found him fighting off a group of shimmering elven warriors. This is a dream! Tanis shouted to Sturm.
Bah!
The knight grunted, then gasped in pain as an arrow thudded into his arm. Sturm, Alhanna said you were an ice wall. The knight shrugged.
Perhaps I was sent to help you.
I must wake up, Tanis told himself, squeezing his eyes shut and then opening them wide. The elves were still there, still fighting. Raistlin must have lied, but to what purpose? Suddenly, Tanis knew. The dragon orb. We've got to reach the tower before Raistlin does, Tanis cried to Sturm. The knight was being attacked by more of the elven undead. One moment the sun shone through the stifling green haze. Then night shadows hovered over the land like the wings of dragons. When the darkness deepened, Sturm and Tanis saw the tower, glistening white. At the sight of it, both men began to run. The elven warriors, seeing their prey escaping, screamed in rage, charging after them. Tanis ran until it seemed his lungs would burst. Sturm ran ahead. But just as Tanis neared the tower, he tripped and pitched headlong onto the ground. Above him, an undead elf raised a spear. Suddenly, the elf's eyes widened. The spear fell from nerveless fingers as a sword punctured its transparent body. Tanis looked up to see who had saved his life. Kitiara! You're here! How? Why?
Kit's crooked smile was as charming as ever. I heard you needed help.
She reached out her hand and he grasped it.
She was flesh and blood.
Kitiara laughed at the surprise on his face. There's Sturm! Just like old times. Shall we go to the tower?
The companions fought through their separate but shared nightmares. Riverwind was set upon by warriors of his own Quaishu tribe, who blamed him for bringing the blue crystal staff among them, causing the tribe's destruction. Tika, stabbing wildly with her eyes closed, opened them to find that she had slain Flint. The dwarf had been wandering aimlessly, feeling his age grow on him, when he wandered up behind Tika. Too late, he had seen the sword flash. Tasselhoff, seeing Tika beset by the undead warriors, ran to the door of the tower and tried to pick the lock, knowing that if Tika could get inside, she would be safe. He fumbled as something bumped into him from behind. It was Tika, dead at his feet. Then, as he sprung the lock, he felt a prick on his finger. The lock had a needle inside it, and the needle was tipped with poison. Tass looked at the spot of blood on his finger and realized that he was about to die. Raistlin and Caramon made their way toward the tower, with Raistlin growing stronger and Caramon weaker every second. Finally, the mage laid his twin down against the wall of the tower, saying he no longer needed him. Raistlin stepped over the bodies of Tika and Tass and went inside the tower. When Sturm, Tanis, and Kitiara reached the tower, Caramon was being hacked to pieces by undead warriors. Before he died, he begged them to protect Raistlin. The three survivors approached the tower, discovering the bodies of Tika and Tass. Tanis knelt beside the kender and saw on the ground nearby the ring Lorana had once given him. With tears in his eyes, Tanis picked up the ring and followed Kit and Sturm into the tower.
A green light was emanating from the end of a long corridor. Movement toward it exacted a terrible toll. Exhaustion claimed them bit by bit. Just as Tanis realized he could not take another step, he heard a voice call his name. Lorana stood in front of him. She ran toward him with a glad cry, then saw Kitiara on his arm. Lorana's face went white.
At that moment, the gigantic green dragon appeared. It crashed through the doorway and moved toward the companions, who stood paralyzed by dragon fear. Just as the dragon neared, however, Raistlin materialized in front of them. Only magic can save us now. But the call of Salamnic trumpets filled Sturm's ears, urging him on to glory. Sturm charged the dragon, impaling himself on its claw. Too late, Sturm heard the draconian horns and realized it was a trap. He slumped to the floor, dead. Lorana ran to Sturm's body and took up his sword. Tanis ran to help her, but turned as Kitiara called his name. Kit was beset by draconians. Tanis hesitated. Lorana's body fell across Sturm's, pierced by draconian swords. Tanis sobbed helplessly as Kitiara too fell. He sobbed in frenzy, then raised his enchanted sword and ran at the dragon. But Raistlin blocked his path, and Tanis fell to the floor. Knowing he was about to die, the half-elf heard the mage chanting and the dragon roaring in rage. Tanis clutched the ring in his hand, the only thing still real to him. The gold bit into his flesh, bit deeply. Pain, real pain, and then it hit him.
I am dreaming!
Tanis opened his eyes. Solinari's silver light flooded the tower, mingled with the red beams of its sister moon, Lunatari. He was lying on a cold marble floor. His hand was clasped tightly, so tightly that pain had wakened him.
The ring! The dream!
Remembering, he sat up in terror. Only Raistlin was with him. The half-elf staggered to his feet. He could see blood on the mage's lips. The blood gleamed red in Lunatari's light, as red as the robes that covered Raistlin's shivering body. Tanis opened his hand. It was empty.
Where are they, Raistlin? Lorana, Sturm, and the others, your brother? Are they dead? And the dragon?
The orb sent the dragon away. You, Tanis, lived because your love was strong. I was saved by my ambition. We clung to reality in the midst of the nightmare. Who can say with the others?
Caramon's alive, then, Tanis said, because of his love for you. Tell me, mage, was this future you say we saw irreversible?
The future changes as we stand here, Tanis. Else we are the game pieces of the gods, not their heirs, as we have been promised. But now we must find the dragon orb. Raistlin shuffled down the hall, leaning upon the staff of mages. Then Tanis heard a booming voice at the other end of the corridor.
Raist!
Caramon, alive and apparently unharmed, came through the doorway and went to his brother. Together the twins walked toward the room where Tanis had seen the green light and the dragon. His heart heavy, Tanis followed. Soon they entered the audience room of the Tower of the Stars. Windows carved into the tower were faceted with gems, once designed to magnify the light of the silver and the red moons. Now the gems were broken. Fractured moonlight filtered in. Tanis looked up. There was only blackness in the sky. No stars shone. But before he could ponder what this portended, he heard Raistlin gasp softly, and he turned. There, in the shadows, sat Alhanna's father, Lorak, the Elf King. He was motionless on his throne, his head back, his mouth wide in a silent scream. His hand rested upon a crystal orb before him on a golden stand.
Is he alive? Tanis breathed.
Raistlin pointed to Lorak's hand.
He is living a nightmare.
He tried to take control of the orb, but he lacked the power. The dragon decided to destroy Sylvanesti by whispering nightmares into Lorak's ear. Nightmares so strong that they became reality.
Tanis shuddered.
So it was his dream we were living when we entered Sylvanesti. The mage nodded.
His dream and our own. For we too came under the dragon's control when we stepped into this land. Only my magic has broken the spell.
Tanis heard a moan and quickly turned.
Alhanna!
The elf maid was crouched at her father's feet, weeping.
I refused to believe in the dream. I woke, but only to find the nightmare was real. My beautiful land filled with horrors.
A faint aura of red surrounded the orb. Tanis turned back to Raistlin.
Tell me this. Can the orb still be of use to us?
Raistlin was silent for a long moment.
Yes, if we dare.
Lorak drew a shivering breath, then screamed, a thin wailing scream horrible to hear.
Father!
Alhanna cried, grasping his bony hands in hers. Lorak lifted a shaking hand to touch her cheek.
My child. Alive. It cannot be.
I saw you dial, Hannah.
Rest now, father.
The nightmare is ended. Putting her arm around him, Alhanna guided Lorak out of the room. Tanis looked out a broken window at the forest. It was still nightmarish and contorted.
Where were his other friends?
Were they all right? What if they had believed in the nightmare? Would they have died? His heart sinking, Tanis knew he would have to go back into that demented forest and search for them. But just as he began to force his weary body to action, his friends entered the room.
I killed him, Tika wailed, catching sight of Tanis. I killed Flint. I didn't mean to, Tanis, I swear.
Hush, Tanis told her. It was only a dream, Tika. An enchanted dream.
My friend, Goldmoon said, reaching out to embrace Tanis. Seeing the somber expression on her face, the half-elf glanced questioningly at Riverwind.
The plainsman only shook his head, his own face pale and grieved. Each of them must have lived through his or her own dream, as Tanis had. With a shudder, he remembered Kitiara. How real she had been. And Lorana dying. But now, as the friends embraced each other, the horror of their nightmares gradually receded into the blessing of their love.
We must all sleep, Tanis thought, feeling his eyes burn. Yet, how can we ever sleep again?
Nevertheless, sleep finally overcame them. Huddled on the floor, they stayed near each other. And while they slept, others, in cold and hostile lands far from Sylvanesti, wakened. Lorana woke first. In the darkness, she had no idea where she was.
Sylvanesti!
She cried, running to Sturm and Flint's tent. Flint woke to find that his fingers still moved. Sturm woke in panic. Lorana gasped at the sight of his haggard face.
Oh, Sturm, my dream was so real. You were in it. I saw you.
What is Sylvanesti like? Sturm interrupted.
Lorana stared at him.
You dreamed of Sylvanesti too?
Flint wiped his face with his hand.
You want me to tell you what I dreamed?
No, Sturm said hurriedly, his face pale. I don't want to talk about it. Ever.
Just then, Tasselhoff burst into the tent. Did I hear you talking about a dream? Well, I had a fantastic dream. Horrible dead elves going around killing people. Raistlin wearing black robes. We were all there, and everyone died. There was a green dragon.
Tasselhoff stopped.
What was wrong with his friends? Well, I guess I'll go, if you don't want to hear more.
No one answered.
Backing out of the tent, Tass shook his head, puzzled, and went back to his own bed. For a moment, no one spoke. Then Flint sighed.
How do you suppose we all came to have this same dream?
A strange land, Sylvanesti, Lorana said. Do you think it was real? Did they die, as we saw?
We didn't die, Sturm pointed out.
This seems funny, but somehow I know they're all right.
Lorana looked at the knight intently for a moment. His grave face had grown calm. Turning, she slipped back into the starlit night. The dwarf rose to his feet.
Well, so much for sleep. I'll take my turn at watch now.
I'll join you, said Sturm, standing and buckling on his sword belt.
The dwarf walked out of the tent. Sturm started to follow, then stopped as his eyes caught a glimpse of light. He bent down to find that the jewel Alhanna had given him had slipped from his belt. It was gleaming with its own inner light.
Morning dawned in Sylvanesti for the first time in many long, horrifying months. But only Lorak saw it. The companions, worn out, slept soundly. Lorak looked outside. A noxious green mist hung over the land filled with twisted, tortured trees. For over 400 years he had lived in this land. He had watched it take shape and flower beneath his hands and the hands of his people. There had been times of trouble, too. Lorak was one of the few still living on Kryn to remember the cataclysm. The elves of Sylvanesti heard, of course, via the winds and birds, of the sufferings of their cousins, the Qualanesti, following the cataclysm. And, though grieved at the tales of rapine and murder, the Sylvanesti asked themselves what could one expect, living among humans. Lorak withdrew with his people into the forest, renouncing the outside world. Thus he could not understand this new evil, sweeping out of the north, threatening his homeland. He had met with the dragon high lords, explaining to them that the Sylvanesti would give them no trouble.
The elves believed everyone had the right to live upon Kryn, evil and good. He talked, and they listened. And all seemed well. Then came the day when Lorak realized he had been deceived. The day the skies erupted with dragons. Lorak bowed his head, tasting bitter tears in his mouth. Then he felt gentle hands upon his shoulders. Alhanna had wakened. Father, come away from the window. Our people will return some day and make the land whole again. The Elf King sobbed.
Our people will never return, Alhanna. Since when have we elves lied to each other?
Perhaps we have always lied to ourselves, Father. The ancient gods did not abandon Kryn. A cleric of Mishikal traveled with us and told us of what she had learned. I did not want to believe, Father. But I see now, the gods are wise. We can no longer live apart from the world. The elves must work to rebuild not only this land, but all lands ravaged by the evil. Lorak listened. His eyes turned from the tortured landscape to his daughter's face, pale and radiant as the silver moon.
Bring our people back, Alhanna.
Yes, Father. I will. I will. Tears flooded her eyes and choked her voice, for she realized Lorak could no longer hear her. His eyes had dimmed, and his head sank back in the chair.
Bury my body in the soil, daughter. As my life brought this curse upon it, perhaps my death will bring its blessing.
Lorak's hand slipped from his daughter's grasp. His lifeless eyes stared out into the tormented land of Sylvanesti. But the look of horror on his face faded away, replaced by peace.
Following Lorak's death, the companions left Sylvanesti. Raistlin carried the dragon orb with him in an enchanted sack, which caused it to shrink when placed inside. Together they traveled north in search of a seaport where they could find passage to Sancrist. Remembering Derek's words, they hoped to be there in time for the Council of Whitestone, which would set the course of future resistance to the dragon armies. More important, perhaps Storm would be there with the others. Alhanna stayed behind to bury her father. Afterwards, she would fly with her griffins to Urgoth to bring her people back. Meanwhile, Storm, Gilfanas, Lorana, Flint, and Tass reached Icewall Castle in the company of Derek and the other two Solamnic knights. There they too found a dragon orb and defeated its evil guardian, Thialfas, a powerful dragon lord. As they prepared to leave, they came upon a startling sight. It was a huge dragon over 40 feet long, its skin a shimmering silver, completely encased in a wall of ice. The dragon's expression was fierce, but its head was noble, and instead of loathing, they felt sorrow for this magnificent creature. On the dragon was a rider, by his armor a knight of Solamnia, frozen in time. Held tightly in his gloved hand was the broken shaft of what once must have been a large lance.
Sturm gazed up at the dragon and its rider. I remember my mother telling me that the legendary knight Humal rode upon a silver dragon, carrying the Dragonlance in his final battle. Derek laughed.
No, this is surely some renegade knight enslaved by evil.
He and the other two knights turned to go, but the companions lingered, staring up at the figure on the dragon.
You're right, Sturm. That's a Dragonlance, Tass said wistfully. I don't know how I know, but I'm sure of it.
Maybe we should take it with us, Lorana suggested. Derek's voice came back to them.
Come, Sturm, Brightblade!
How can we get it? Sturm asked, ignoring Derek's order. It's encased in ice at least 3 feet thick.
I can get it, Gilfanas said. Jumping up onto the huge cliff of ice, the elf found a handhold and began to inch his way up the monument. Gilfanas pressed his hand against the ice covering the lance and spoke the spidery language of magic. A red glow spread from his hand, melting the ice rapidly. Within moments, Gilfanas was able to reach in to grasp the lance. But it was held fast in the dead knight's hand, as if the lance and the hand had become a single unit. Sturm climbed up beside him and put his hand through the hole. As he took hold of the lance,
the ice-bound figure of the knight relaxed its grip. "He's giving it to you," cried Lorana. Taking hold of the broken weapon, Sturm lifted it out of the ice. Then he jumped back to the ground, staring at the ancient shaft. Derek appeared.
"I gave you an order, Bright Blade. What's the delay?"
Derek's face darkened as he saw the lance.
"I asked him to get it for me." Lorana's voice was as cool as the ice behind her.
Taking the lance, she began to wrap it swiftly in a fur cloak from a pack. Derek regarded her angrily for a moment, then bowed stiffly and turned on his heel.
"What if it's evil?" Sturm asked Lorana as they traveled the corridors of Icewall Castle.
"Sturm, do you believe the story of humor?"
"I don't know any more.
My mother taught me the story is the truth. Then I went to Salamnia. I found that the knighthood was not the order of honorable, self-sacrificing men my mother had described. It was rife with political intrigue. The best of them were like Derek, honorable but strict, superior and unbending. The worst, when I spoke of humor, they laughed."
Saddened by the sorrow in Sturm's face, Lorana persisted.
"But did humor really exist?"
"Oh, yes. The records that survived the cataclysm list his name among the lower orders of the knights. But the story of the silver dragon, the final battle, even the Dragonlance itself, no one believes anymore. There is no proof. The Tomb of Humor, according to the legend, was a towering structure, one of the wonders of the world. But you can find no one who has ever seen it."
Sturm gave a deep, shuddering sigh.
I miss Tanis.
I miss Caramon, Tika, all of them. I feel as if a part of me has been cut off. These people, my friends, were doing more to combat evil than all the knights of Salamnia. Even Raceland. And he could tell us what all this means. Oh, if only Tanis were here.
Yes, Lorana said quietly. If Tanis were here.
Remembering her sorrow, so much greater than his own, Sturm put his arm around her and held her close. Then Derek's voice came sharply back to them, reprimanding them for lagging behind. And now the broken lance, wrapped in Lorana's fur cloak, lay in the chest with the dragon orb and worm slayer, Tanis's sword, which they had carried with them from Tarsus. A strong southern wind propelled their ship across the Sirion Sea.
"That way lies southern Urgoth,"
the captain told Elistan, pointing off to starboard.
Filled with elves, they say. Though I haven't been there to know if that's true."
"Elves!" Lorana looked at Gilthanas eagerly. "Perhaps it's our people."
"Most likely the Sylvanesti," Gilthanas said. "In fact, I think Lady Alhanna may have mentioned something about Urgoth. Do you remember, Sturm?"
"No," the knight replied.
Walking over to the port side of the ship, Sturm leaned against the railing, staring out at the pink-tinged sea. Lorana saw him pull something from his belt and run his fingers over it lovingly. There was a bright flash as it caught the sun's rays. Then he slipped it back into his belt. Lorana started to go to him, then suddenly stopped.
"What kind of strange cloud is that to the south?"
The captain turned immediately, whipping his spyglass out of the pocket of his fur parka and placing it to his eye. It certainly seemed to be a cloud. It was huge and white and appeared to be floating above the water. But it was moving much more rapidly than any other cloud in the sky, and Tasselhoff gasped, his Kender eyes the sharpest of all.
"It's not a cloud. It's a dragon."
The dragon was white, one of a small, unintelligent breed that breathed ice instead of fire. This one had been sent to find the dragon orb that had been stolen from Icewall. The white dragon froze the ship, meaning to drag it to shore and kill its occupants, then take the orb and bring it directly to the Dark Queen. But the dragon hadn't counted on the storm which arose, driving the ship onto the rocks and splitting it apart. The companions, who had taken shelter below decks, dragged the chest with the orb to shore. In the darkness, Lorana, with her elven sight, succeeded in crippling the dragon's wing with a well-aimed arrow. The wounded white dragon flew back to Icewall, but the companions had no time to rejoice. They were immediately captured by Sylvanesti elves, who took them for Qualinesti spies. It seemed the two races of elves who had both sought refuge on southern Urgoth Island mistrusted each other so much that they were now on the brink of war. When Gil'thanas tried to protest, the Sylvanesti warriors beat him unconscious. Only when Lorana explained that they were of the royal house of Qualinesti did the Sylvanesti elves begin to treat them civilly. They called for a healer to tend to Gil'thanas' head wound. This healer was a woman of the local elven tribe, the Kaganesti, also called Wilder Elves. These primitive elves had at first welcomed their cousins to Urgoth, only to become enslaved by the more sophisticated Qualinesti and Sylvanesti. The young woman was covered with filth, but she was a talented healer, and Gil'thanas was soon feeling better. When he could walk, the Sylvanesti escorted Gil'thanas and the companions to the camp of the Qualinesti. There they were led before Lorana and Gil'thanas' father, the Speaker of the Suns, and his eldest son, Crown Prince Porthios. The old man was overjoyed to see his son Gil'thanas, whom he had given up for dead. He welcomed Lorana, too, but with less warmth. Gil'thanas told his father how they had come to find a dragon orb, and that they wanted to take it to the headquarters of the Knights of Salamnia at Sandcrest and present it at the Council of Whitestone.
The speaker's eyes glittered angrily.
My son brought the orb into this land. It is ours by right.
Gil'thanas flushed as he felt the companion's eyes turn to him. I do not claim that, father. Porthios shot his younger brother a furious glance.
Do you think we are foolish enough to let the orb be taken by humans to cause more trouble in this world?
Derek slammed his fist on the table.
Fool! The dragons seek to conquer all Ancelon, including this miserable isle. If we fall, you fall too.
He speaks truly, father, Lorana said, greatly daring. Elven women did not attend war meetings, much less speak.
Porthios, the dragon High Lord wanted the extermination of our race. Have you forgotten?
Lorana!
The Speaker of the Suns rose to his full height, taller even than his eldest son.
You have no right to speak to your elder brother like that. He remembered his duty and his responsibility, as did Gil'thanas. They did not go running off after a half-elven bastard like a...
Lorana went white.
You were about to say, like a human whore?
Her words fell like pins on nerves stretched taut. The speaker's face was tight.
Go to your lodgings, Lorana.
So that's what you think of me,
Lorana whispered, her throat constricting. Porthios sneered at her.
What do you expect, sister? You wear a sword stained with blood. You talk glibly of adventures, traveling with humans and dwarves. By the way, where is Tanis? Did your half-breed lover tire of you?
As Porthios lashed out at her, the firelight flared before Lorana's eyes. Heat swept over her body, and then terrible cold. She remembered only a horrifying sensation of falling. Falling.
Lorana, my daughter,
she heard. Then nothing.
I can't see. Where am I? Who are you?
Lorana felt gentle hands take her own as she sat up.
Drink, mistress.
Lorana sipped at the cup of clear, cold water. Her strength returned, and she could see again. She was in her room, in her father's house. Across from her sat the Kaganesti elf maid who had healed her brother.
I am Silvara, mistress,
the girl said, giving a little bow.
I ran from the Sylvanesti when they brought you across the river. Please, take me with you when you leave.
Looking at her closely, Lorana saw that the wilder elf must be a beautiful woman if the filth were washed from her.
Silvara? That means silver head in Kaganesti, does it not?
The girl nodded.
I know the way through the mountains to reach the knight's outpost where ships with birds' wings sail. I will help you get away.
Lorana searched her face.
Why would you do this for us? I know you carry the dragon orb. I know it is important to end this war.
Lorana was puzzled. The girl seemed sincere, but somehow Lorana couldn't trust her. Perhaps she was a spy.
I must talk to Alistan, Silvara. Can you bring him here? He has been waiting outside for you to awaken, mistress. Where are the rest of my friends?
Lord Gil'thanas is with your father. Was it Lorana's imagination, or did Silvara's pale cheek flush when she mentioned Gil'thanas?
The others are in guest quarters.
Quietly, Silvara went to the door, opened it, and beckoned. Alistan entered.
and Lorana flung her arms around him. Silvara has offered to help us escape with the orb, Elistan. Elistan was calm.
Then you should waste no more time.
Lorana blinked. Elistan, you're coming with us.
No, Lorana. I have sought help from Paladine, and I must stay here, with the elves. I believe if I stay, I will be able to convince your father that I am a cleric of the true gods. If I left, he would always believe I am a charlatan, as your brother Portheus thinks. Your honor, take the orb to the Council of Whitestone at Sancrist. And may Paladine's blessing go with you.
Elistan,
Lorana whispered, but the cleric had already turned to go. Silvara quietly shut the door, and Lorana laid her head down wearily on her knees. She would have to leave now. Sturm and Derek were caught up in their own quarrel, and who knew if Gilthanas would continue to take their part against his father and brother? No, it was up to her, and there could be no turning back.
Oh, Tanis, she thought, what should I do? She could almost see the weariness and sorrow on Tanis's face.
We depended on him, whether he wanted us to or not. When he felt lost or frightened, he did what he believed was right. And so must I. Stern paced the length of the crude cabin that had been given to them, unable to sleep as the dwarf lay snoring. Across the room, Tasselhoff lay curled in a ball of misery, chained by his foot to the bedpost to prevent his running away. Derek lifted his head from his pillow.
Must you pace about like that?
Psst, Stern said, raising his hand in warning. Through a hole cut in the roof for ventilation, Sturm heard an odd, shuffling, scraping sound. He fell back in alarm as the stars he had been watching through the hole were suddenly blotted out by a dark, shapeless mass.
Sturm! Sturm Brightblade!
Said a voice. Thoughts of solace flooded Sturm's mind.
Theros! Theros Ironfeld! Derek! Theros is an old friend of ours from Solace. The Draconians hacked off his arm for helping elves escape. What are you doing here, Theros? The last I saw you, you were lying near death in the Elven Kingdom.
The huge blacksmith struggled down through the opening in the ceiling.
Hush,
he commanded.
No time for questions. The Lady Lorana sent me. We're to meet her in the woods beyond the camp. Make haste.
Theros strode over to look at Tasselhoff, who was trying without success to free himself. The smith chuckled. Taking hold of the chain in his hands, he gave a sudden heave, and it split apart. Tasselhoff stared at the smith's arms. One arm, the left, was a dusky black, the color of the smith's skin. But the other arm, the right, was bright, shining silver.
Theros, your arm!
Questions later, little thief. Now we move swift and silent.
While her father slept, Lorana sneaked into his room and retrieved the dragon orb and lance. Led by Theros Ironfeld and Silvara, who knew the land, they came to the river border between the territories of the Qualinesti and the Silvanesti. There they were met by Kaganesti oarsmen, who shepherded them upstream to safety. If escape was so easy, Lorana wondered why Silvara had remained a slave of the Silvanesti, unless escape had not been her real purpose.
Tass put his small hand into the water. Look, he said in excitement. His hand was coated in silver and sparkled in the early morning light.
The water glitters. Look, Flint.
You're right, Kendikin, Silvara said. In fact, the Silvanesti named the river Thonsagan, which means Silver Road.
What causes it?
Tass asked, studying his hand with delight. There is a legend among my people. Silvara fell silent abruptly, her face flushed.
What legend? Gilthanas asked. He sat facing Silvara. His paddling was not much better than Flint's, Gilthanas being much more interested in Silvara's face than in his work.
It is a child's tale about humor.
Humor? Sturm stopped paddling for a moment.
Tell us your legend of humor, Wilder Elf.
Clearing her throat, Silvara began. According to the Kaganesti, in the last days of the terrible dragon wars, humor traveled through the land. He prayed to the gods for an answer to the destruction by the dragons. And Paladine answered, sending him the white stag. It led him to a quiet grove here in the land of Urgoth. In the grove, he met a woman, beautiful and virtuous, who eased his pain. Humor fell in love with her, and she with him.
Their joy was brief, however, for the woman had a terrible secret. She was not born of woman, but of dragon. Only by magic did she keep the shape of womankind. Fearfully, she revealed to Humor what she was, appearing before him one night in her true shape, that of a silver dragon. Looking at the radiant creature before him, the knight saw within her eyes the noble spirit of the woman he loved. She prayed to Paladine to return her to the shape of a woman, saying she would give up her magic and the long lifespan of dragons to live in the world with Humor. Savara closed her eyes, her face drawn with pain. Yothanis wondered why she was so affected by this legend. Reaching out, he touched her hand. What was Paladine's answer? Savara drew a deep breath. Paladine granted her wish with a terrible condition. If she remained a dragon, she and Humor would be given the Dragonlance and the power to defeat the evil dragons. If she became mortal, she and Humor would live together as man and wife, but the evil dragons would remain in the land forever. She knew the answer she must give. The Silver River, it is said, was formed from the tears shed by the dragon when Humor left her to find the Dragonlance. One of the Kaganesti pointed at Gilfanus and said something sharply to Silvara. The elf maid smiled. He asks if you are too grand an elf lord to paddle, because if you are, he will allow your lordship to swim. Gilfanus grinned at her, his face flushing. Quickly he picked up his paddle and set to work. By the time they made landfall, their muscles ached with the strain. It was all they could do to drag the boats ashore and hide them.
Do you think we've thrown off the pursuit?
Lorana asked Theros wearily. Theros nodded.
None dare travel the river at night.
Lorana's gaze went to Savara, who stood on the riverbank, talking to Gilfanus.
Theros, what do you know of Savara?
I know she is much loved by her people, especially for her healing skills.
Theros saw Lorana's face harden.
You disapprove of her, I think.
Lorana felt her skin burn under the smith's scrutiny.
I simply don't trust the girl. That's all.
It was as Tanis had always said. She had to trust her instincts. She would keep an eye on Silvara. Every muscle in Gilfanus's body cried out for rest, but the elf lord could only stare at the sky. By the gods, his values were getting as muddled as Lorana's. First, his hatred for Tanis was starting to dwindle away, replaced by admiration, and even affection. His attitude towards other races was changing as well. The Kender, the dwarf, he liked them. And he'd known few elves as noble as the human, Stern Brightblade. But he never had dreamed he would fall in love with a wilder elf. There, Gilfanus said aloud, I've admitted it. I love her. He grinned, thinking of Silvara's dirt-streaked face, filthy hair, tattered clothes.
My soul's eye must be seeing more clearly than my head, he thought, glancing over at her bedroll.
It was empty. Astonished, Gilfanus rose to his feet quickly and began to search for her. A sudden chilling thought crossed his mind. Hurriedly, he looked for the dragon orb. It was still there. Gilfanus breathed more easily. Then his quick ears caught the sound of water splashing. He walked silently through the dark forest to a place where the water flowed into a small pool. Here Gilfanus stopped. And here his heart almost stopped beating. He had found Silvara. Oblivious to the chill air, the elf maid was partly submerged in the water, her shoulders and arms visible to Gilfanus' elven sight. Her clothes lay scattered on the bank next to a frayed blanket. The elf lord knew he should leave, but he was held fast, entranced. Silvara rose up out of the pool. The silvery water ran in shimmering rivulets down her body, painting her in silver moonlight. Gilfanus gasped in awe. Alerted, Silvara ran to where her clothes lay, but she made no move to clothe herself. Instead, she grabbed a knife. Silvara! The elf lord spoke in a firm yet hushed tone as he moved with slow, smooth steps toward her. It's me, Gilfanus. The innermost thoughts of his heart began pouring out of him. Silvara, my people need me.
Yet I am here, taking the dragon orb away to give to humans to aid them in their war. Why, Silvara? Why have I done this to my people? Slowly, Silvara lowered her knife. There was such sadness in her eyes that Gilfanus looked away, ashamed of himself. Silvara, forgive me for involving you in my trouble. I don't understand what it is that I must do. I only know that you must do it. Silvara finished for him. Gilfanus looked up. Silvara had covered herself with her frayed blanket. This modest effort served only to fan the flames of his desire. Silvara, what I have done is against all elven custom. When Lorana told me of her plan to leave with the orb, I should have gone directly to my father. Now she took a step toward him. Why didn't you? Because I know my people are wrong. Their laws, their customs are wrong. Lorana is right. Stern is right. I know this in my heart, but I can't make my head believe it. Silvara walked slowly toward him. I understand. Silvara, I love you. You are alone as I am. Please, Silvara, you will never be alone again. I swear it. Hesitantly, Silvara lifted her hand toward his, her eyes filled with tears. Gilfanus pulled her to him. He could feel her body trembling, but he knew now, as he looked into her eyes, that she trembled with passion, not fear. Cupping her face in his hands, he kissed her tenderly. Silvara's blanket slipped unnoticed into the stream and was borne away by the silver water. By noon the next day, the companions reached the river's headwaters. Dragging their boats ashore, they were met by a group of Kaganesti elves coming out of the woods. Some drew weapons and would have attacked had not Theros Ironfeld and Silvara hurried to talk with them. When Theros returned, his dark face was somber. Silvara's was flushed with anger.
"My people will do nothing to help us," she reported. "They've been attacked by lizardmen twice in the last 2 days. They blame the coming of this new evil on humans, who they say brought them here in a white-winged ship."
"That's ridiculous," Lorana snapped. "Theros, didn't you tell them about these draconians?"
"I tried."
"What are draconians doing here anyway?" Lorana asked. "Is Urgoth being invaded, Theros?"
"No, I think not. These appear to be small patrols sent out as agitators. The High Lords probably hope the elves will save them the trouble of a war by destroying each other first."
"The dragon armies are not ready to attack Urgoth," Derek said. "They haven't got a firm hold on the north yet. But it's only a matter of time. We must get the orb to Sancrist quickly." Gathering their supplies, the companions set out for the high country. Silvara led them along a trail beside the river. She was an exceptional guide, pushing them along at a rapid pace as she walked with Gilfanus at her side. Before sundown, they came to a cave.
"Here we can spend the night," Silvara said, "but we dare not light a fire."
Exhausted by the day's climb, they ate a cheerless meal, then made their beds in the cave. The next morning, Tasselhoff squeezed out through the cave's hidden entrance to take a look around. Then he hurried back inside. Putting his finger to his lips, Tass motioned them to follow him outdoors. He led them to a spot not 20 feet from the cave and pointed at the white snow. On it were the fresh footprints of elven boots.
"We dare not stay here any longer," Silvara said.
Flint pointed at their own tracks.
"It won't make much difference. We might as well just sit and wait for them." "Maybe we cannot hide our trail," said Theros. "But we can gain some miles on them, perhaps."
Derek loosed his sword in its scabbard. "Perhaps." Lorana caught hold of Sturm's arm.
"Please," she pleaded. "It must not come to bloodshed."
Sturm set his jaw and shook his head. "We cannot allow your people to stop us from taking the orb to Sancrist." Biting her lip, Lorana ran back to the cave, unwilling to let the others see her cry.
"The day I fight my own people," she swore aloud, "is the day the dragons have won."
She stopped suddenly and whirled around, hearing a noise.
"Silvara? I thought you had gone. What are you doing?"
Lorana moved to where Silvara knelt in the darkness, her hands busy with something on the cavern floor.
"I'm just getting my things."
Behind Silvara, Lorana thought she saw the dragon orb.
But before she could look more closely, Silvara swiftly dropped her cloak over the object.
We must hurry, Lorana.
In a moment. Lorana started to walk past the wilder elf, but Silvara's hand clutched at her.
Let go of me,
Lorana said coldly, pulling away from the girl. Lorana walked to the back of the shallow cave. Looking down, she saw a tangle of twigs and bark and stones. If it was a sign, it was a clumsy one. Lorana kicked at it, scattering the collection.
There! Whatever message you left will be difficult to read.
When she turned, Silvara was already outside. Perhaps I am being too suspicious of the girl, Lorana thought, hurrying out of the cave. Then about halfway up the trail, she stopped abruptly. What a fool she'd been! What fools they'd all been! She remembered Silvara rising to her feet, dropping her cloak. It was the dragon orb she had seen, shining with a strange light. Her thoughts were shattered when an arrow zinged through the air and thudded into a tree near Derek's head.
Elves! Brightblade, attack!
Derek cried, drawing his sword.
No! Just run!
Lorana ran forward, grabbing his sword arm.
Another arrow flew by. They're not aiming to kill! Put your sword away, Derek,
Stern said,
or you'll fight me first. You're a coward, Brightblade. You're running from the enemy. No, I'm running from my friends. Get moving, Derek. Don't force me to kill you.
His face splotched with fury. Derek plunged ahead up the trail, climbing rapidly. Behind her, Lorana could hear Theros crashing through the snow, occasionally stopping to send a boulder bouncing down after them. Soon it sounded like the entire side of the mountain was sliding down the steep trail, and the arrow ceased. The smith puffed, catching up with Sturm and Lorana.
That won't stop them for long.
Lorana's lungs were on fire. Blue and gold stars burst before her eyes.
Must rest,
she said, her throat aching.
No, Silvara said urgently. Just a few more feet. Come on, keep going.
The wilder elf dragged Lorana forward. Finally, they came to the top of the pass. Lorana slumped into the snow, exhausted. The rest sank down beside her, all except Silvara, who was staring below them. Where does she get the strength, Lorana wondered. Silvara turned to face them.
We must split up. You, Derek, must take the dragon orb to Sancrist alone. We will draw off the pursuit.
Lorana flashed a look of alarm at Sturm. I do not think one person should be charged with such a grave responsibility, Sturm said. Two should go, at least.
Meaning yourself, Brightblade?
Derek asked angrily.
Yes, of course Sturm should go,
Lorana said.
If anyone.
I can draw a map through the mountains, Silvara said eagerly. The way is not difficult.
Sturm protested.
What about our tracks? Surely the elves will see we've split up.
An avalanche,
Silvara suggested.
Theros throwing the boulders down behind us gave me the idea. I will bring you to a place known only to my people. Please, there isn't much time.
Derek stared at Sturm. I order you to stay behind, Brightblade. Sturm stared right back at him. You have no authority over me. Have you forgotten? I am not a knight. Gnashing his teeth, Derek gathered his gear. Lorana pulled herself to her feet and went to Sturm.
Farewell, my friend, she whispered.
He kissed her gently on the forehead. We will give the orb to the wise men to study. The Council of Whitestone will meet soon. Come to Sancrist as soon as possible, Lorana.
If God's willing, I'll be there.
Her eyes went to Silvara, who was handing Derek the orb. A look of inexpressible relief flitted over Silvara's face when Derek turned to go. Sturm said goodbye, then plunged into the snow after Derek. Suddenly, Lorana took a step forward.
Wait! The Dragonlance!
No!
Silvara shouted, blocking Lorana's path and staring at the elf maid with eyes bluer than midnight. Lorana felt her will being drained by those blue, blue eyes. They all stood there, unable to move, completely under Silvara's control. The Dragonlance stays with me, Silvara said, looking around at the spellbound group. As do all of you. Again, without quite understanding why, the companions obeyed.
As the companions made their escape, following the river up into the mountains, Gilthanas came to realize that he had fallen in love with Silvara. One night the two consummated their love. But while Gilthanas was now happy, talking about their future together, Silvara only grew sadder and more secretive. She led the group into the mountains, keeping just ahead of their Qualinesti pursuers. At last, the elves drew within firing range. Derek commanded Sturm to attack, but Sturm refused, knowing the elves were not out to kill them, only to recover the dragon orb. And attacking would provoke war between elves and humans, dooming any chance of defeating the forces of darkness. Silvara came up with a plan. Sturm and Derek would take the orb to Sancrist and give it to the wise men to study. She would lead the others to safety, drawing off the elven pursuit. They would all meet later, in Sancrist, for the Council of Whitestone. When Narana remembered that the knights had left without the Dragonlance, Silvara quickly placed everyone under a hypnotic spell and led them onward, spellbound, to the safety of a mist-filled glen, where she at last released them from the spell, but still refused to answer their questions. Here there was a gigantic statue of a dragon carved out of a cliff face. It was the site of the Tomb of Huma, and here they were safe from elven pursuit, for Silvara alone knew of the secret entrance. She led them inside the burial chamber, where they could rest. Here Tasselhoff found a metal plate covering a hole in the floor. Silvara warned them all not to touch the plate. Flint, meanwhile, was speculating on what kind of huge creature could have carved the gigantic statue of a dragon. Silvara, growing suddenly afraid, began chanting words of magic to place them all under a sleeping spell.
Tasselhoff heard Silvara chanting. Recognizing the words of a magic spell, he reacted instinctively, grabbed hold of the shield that lay on the bier, and pulled. The heavy shield fell on top of him, covering the kendo completely. He lay still beneath it until he heard Silvara finish her spell. Finally, growing bored, Tass crept out from beneath the shield with the silence of a falling feather. All his friends were asleep. But where was Silvara? Cautiously, Tass raised his head and peered over the bier. To his astonishment, he saw Silvara crouched near the tomb entrance. She rocked back and forth, moaning.
"I must break the oath," Tass heard her say. "I love him."
Silvara buried her face in her knees. The tender-hearted Kender had never seen such sorrow, and he longed to go comfort her. Only what she was talking about didn't sound good. The Kender tiptoed around the bier. There was the hole, still gaping open. Without another thought, Tass lowered himself silently into the hole and began his descent. The walls were slick with moisture and moss. He was so preoccupied that he didn't notice the gems until they were right in front of his face.
"By Reox's beard," he swore, "why would anyone put such wonderful jewels down here?"
His hand closed on an enormous emerald.
A tremendous blast of wind filled the shaft, pulling the kender off the wall, making him lose his handhold. Falling, Tass looked back up, watching the light at the top grow smaller and smaller. First, the wind tumbled him end over end. Then it switched directions, blowing him sideways through another tunnel. Then he suddenly felt himself start to rise. A great wind was wafting him up, yet another great stone tunnel. Just as he decided that he could really enjoy taking up flying as a way of life, Tass reached the top of the shaft. Jumping out of the air currents, he landed lightly on a stone floor and began to look around. Several torches flared on the walls, illuminating the chamber with a bright white radiance. He was standing at the bottom of a great, curving staircase. Who lit the torches, he wondered. Just to be safe, Tass reached into his tunic and drew out his little knife. Holding it in his hand, he climbed the stairs to the balcony. Tass suddenly realized that he must be inside the neck and head of the stone dragon. A huge mural extended on around the balcony in foot after foot of shimmering color. Now where have I seen that before? He wondered. He continued walking along the balcony, his eyes on the painting. He just reached the central portion of the mural when he gasped. There were red dragons, and black, and blue, and white, breathing fire and ice. But fighting them were other dragons. Dragons of silver and of gold. The Kenda began jumping up and down, yelling. I remember, it was in Pax Tharkas. His band showed me. There are good dragons in the world. They'll help us fight the evil ones. We just have to find them. And there are the Dragonlances.
Confound it! Snarled a voice below him. Can't a person get some sleep? You're making noise enough to wake the dead.
Tass turned in alarm, his knife in his hand.
Fizban?
Where?
The old man whirled around, peering into the darkness. Tass reached out a trembling hand and tugged at the old man's robe. I'm not sure, but I think you're Fizban. Jumping up gleefully, he hugged the old man. We all thought you were dead.
Fizban? Yes, well, my memory is not what it was, but if I'm not dead, it just goes to show you I'm a damn good magician. By the way, Kendrickson, what are you doing here?
I came with some of my friends. We're here with Silvara.
Oh, Silvara. Well, where is she? And your friends? Where are they?
Downstairs. Silvara cast a spell on them.
Oh, did she? Did she? Well, we'll see about that. Come on.
The old man started off along the balcony, walking so rapidly that Tass had to run to keep up. Descending the stairs to the hole in the floor Tass had come up through, the old man stepped out into its center. Tass joined him, clutching at the old man's robes. They hung suspended over nothing but darkness, feeling cold air waft up around them.
Down,
the old man said. Tasselhoff peered down, fascinated, and started to ask a question, but Fizban shushed him. Gripping his staff, the mage began whispering to himself, making an odd sign in the air. Lorana opened her eyes. She was lying on a cold stone bench, staring at a black, glistening ceiling. Sitting up swiftly, she flashed a glance around the room. Flint was groaning and rubbing his neck. Theros blinked and looked around, puzzled. Gilthanas, already on his feet, stood at the end of Huma's tomb, gazing down at something by the door. As Lorana walked over to him, he turned around and nodded toward the doorway. Silvara sat with her head in her arms, sobbing bitterly. The angry words on Lorana's lips died. Silvara? Instantly the girl leaped up, her tear-stained face white with fear. How did you free yourself from my spell?
That was my doing,
announced a deep voice. Lorana and the rest turned around to see a white-bearded old man in mouse-colored robes rise up solemnly out of the hole in the floor. Fizban, whispered Lorana in disbelief.
You have broken your oath, Silvara,
Fizban boomed. No, the girl moaned, writhing on the ground at the old mage's feet. No, I haven't. Not yet.
Where is the orb?
Stern has it. He took it to Sancrist.
Who?
Fizban peered around and saw Lorana.
Oh, hello there, my dear. It is so nice to see you again. How is your father?
My father? Lorana shook her head, confused. But Fizban, we thought you were... Fizban extended a hand to Gilthanas.
It's good to see you, son, and you, sir.
He bowed to an astonished Theros.
Silver arm? My. What a coincidence. Theros Ironfeld, isn't it? Heard a lot about you. My name is,
Fizban, Tasselhoff reminded him. Before Lorana could sort out her whirling thoughts, Fizban turned to her.
Lorana, I will leave it to Silvara to tell you who she is. I have a long journey ahead of me. Farewell, Silvara.
He waited impatiently a minute, glaring at Tasselhoff.
Are you coming? I haven't got all night.
Coming? With you? The Kenter stood up. Of course. Let me get my pack. Then he looked back at the unconscious Flint.
Oh, he'll be fine,
Fizban promised. The old man stepped into the darkness. Tasselhoff ran after him, his pouches bouncing. Goodbye, Lorana. Goodbye, Theros. Take care of Flint. All eyes turned to Silvara, although her face was filled with sorrow. It was not the tormented, bitter sorrow they had seen earlier. Silvara walked toward Gilthanas and took his hands. I am losing you, Silvara. I see it in your eyes. But why? Gilthanas, take a torch off the wall behind me. As he held the torch aloft, Silvara's shadow sprang into life on the wall behind her. The companions gasped. It was not the shadow of an elf maid. It was the shadow of a dragon.
You're a dragon,
Lorana said in shocked disbelief. She laid her hand on a sword, but Theros stopped her.
No. I remember that old man. He used to come into the Inn of the Last Home in Solace. He told stories to the children. Stories about good dragons. Gold dragons and...
Silver dragons, Silvara said. I am a silver dragon.
My sister was the silver dragon who loved humor and fought the final great battle with him.
No! Gilthanis cried. This is a nightmare!
Where are the rest of these good dragons?
Theros asked. There are many of us. Theros went to Savara and shook her.
If there are many of you, band together. Help us fight the evil dragons.
No,
Savara cried fiercely, her blue eyes flaring. Arana fell back a pace before her anger.
Why not? I cannot tell you. What I have done is bad enough. I turned myself into an elf in order to bring about peace among the elven races. When you arrived, I saw that the danger was too great. So I decided to bring the orb here and keep it safe forever. Then I realized the knights would never allow it to remain here. So I sent it away. That was the wrong decision, but how was I to know?
Why?
Theros asked.
What does the orb do? Is it evil?
Great evil, Savara murmured. Great good. Who can say? Even I do not understand the dragon orbs.
But the book Tash read said they could be used to control dragons,
Theros insisted. Savara sighed. That is true. It is too true. As I fear your friends, the Salamic Knights may discover to their bitter regret. The companions, fear closing around them, sat together in silence, broken only by Gilthanas' sobs. Lorana remembered Huma and the Silver Dragon. She thought of that last terrible battle, the skies filled with dragons, the land erupting in flame and in blood. Why have you brought us here, then? Can I tell them? Savara whispered to an unseen spirit. She sat quietly for a long time. Then, rising to her feet, Savara walked over to Lorana's pack. Kneeling down, she carefully unwrapped the broken shaft of wood that the companions had carried with them. Theros of the Silver Arm, she said, going to him. To you, I give the power to forge the Dragonlance. To the east, across Ancelon from the Vale of the Dragon Cave, Raceland stood in the small doorway of the wagon, peering into the sunlit woods. Nothing stirred. Raceland nodded grimly. Good. He went back inside the wagon and shut the doors firmly. In the weeks since their adventure at the Tower of the Stars, he and his brother Caramon, along with Tika, Riverwind, and Goldmoon, had journeyed northeast from Sylvan Esti with their leader, Tanis Halfelven, stopping here and there along the way to earn their keep by putting on a show they developed. It was called The Red Wizard and His Wonderful Illusions, and it featured Raceland doing a mix of tricks and real magic. Tika danced, Caramon performed feats of strength, and Goldmoon sang songs of entrancement, reaching into the listeners' souls to implant an important message that the true gods were all around them, just waiting to be called upon. Slowly, the message of hope was being spread among the people. The citizens of Eastern Ancelon had gotten off lucky so far. The Draconians left them alone. Dragon High Lords were not interested in the sparsely populated areas on the shore of the Blood Sea of Istar. They were still preoccupied in the north and west. Besides, what was there to conquer here but a few wretched humans and Kendermore, homeland of the Kender? Over several weeks, the companions had earned enough money to book passage to Sanchrist. They were on their way now to Flotsam, a lawless frontier port full of smugglers and pirates, where most shipowners were not yet in the Dragon High Lord's pay. Tonight, they planned to enter Flotsam under the cover of darkness. Raceland knew he would have privacy until nightfall. Tanis and Riverwind were hunting. Caramon and Tika were off somewhere together. Goldmoon was preparing food. No one would bother him. Sitting down at a small table, Raceland carefully opened the little sack he kept hidden in his robes and brought forth the dragon orb. It felt as cold as a hailstone, and a green light swirled within it. He set the orb down. It began to grow. Or perhaps he was shrinking. Raceland couldn't tell. He must stay in control, he knew, for the orb was playing subtle tricks to undermine him. Soon these tricks would not be subtle.
Raislin felt his throat tighten. He coughed, cursing his weak lungs. I must relax, he thought. I am strong. Silently, he called upon the orb. Look at the power I have attained. The orb's colors swirled softly. It did not answer. Raislin placed his hands upon its crystal surface and spoke the ancient words. Ast suakala tantangusa. He did not know how he knew the words, only that he did know. Slowly the drifting green color was submerged in a light neither white nor black, all colors, yet none. Out of the light came two hands. They grasped his strongly. The orb vanished, the room vanished. Raislin saw nothing around him. Nothing but two hands, holding his. Out of sheer terror, Raislin concentrated on those hands. Tightening his own grip, the mage summoned all of his will and pulled the hands toward him. The two wills were locked in a life-or-death contest. Raislin focused every nerve in his frail body on regaining control. Slowly, slowly, Raislin felt the hands cease their tug. What are you? He questioned silently. Are you good? Evil? I am everything. At your command, I will call them to me. They cannot resist my call. They will obey. Will they turn upon their masters? Will they heed my command? That depends on the strength of the master and the bond between the two. In most cases, the dragons will do what you ask of them. They cannot help themselves. I do not understand. Raislin felt himself growing weaker. Be easy. I will aid you. Now that we have joined, you may seek my help often. I know of many secrets long forgotten. They can be yours. Tell me, I must know, Raislin cried silently. This only will I tell you. Then you must rest. In the library of Estinus of Palanthus are books taken there by the mages of old in the days of the battles against the king priest. What do the books contain? Raislin whispered. Then he knew, and darkness crashed over him like the wave of an ocean. In a cave nearby, warmed by the heat of their passion, Tika and Caramon lay in each other's arms. Please, Caramon, love me, she whispered. We want each other. I'm not afraid. Caramon closed his eyes and sighed, pushing the girl from him. I love you, Tika, as much as any man loves any woman. If we weren't involved in this stupid war, I'd make you mine today. But I can't. My first commitment is to my brother.
Caramon!
Tanis's call came from the direction of the wagon.
Caramon, come quickly! What is it?
Caramon burst into the tiny room.
Christ?
Tanis nodded, his face grave. I found him like this. Raislin lay on the floor, his skin white, his breathing shallow. Blood trickled from his mouth.
Raist, what happened?
Caramon bent low, his brother's breath cold upon his skin.
Mine, Raislin whispered. Spells of the ancients. Mine, mine.
Raislin's thin lips parted in a smile.
When they arrived in Sandcrest, Sturm and Derek found the Salamnic knights divided into squabbling political factions. Sturm was immediately put on trial, accused by Derek of insubordination and cowardice, both at Icewall and during their flight from the Elves. The tribunal was headed by Lord Gunthar, Derek's chief rival for the position of Grand Master of the Salamnic Order. Gunthar was sympathetic to Sturm's situation, but politically the tide was pulling in Derek's direction, with all but the youngest knights on his side. Besides, there were no witnesses to confirm Sturm's version of events. Gunthar had no choice but to find Sturm guilty, but he imposed a very light sentence. Sturm could not wear the armor of the Salamnic knights. On the other hand, he would become a Salamnic knight on Gunthar's personal honor and would be assigned as third in command of the forces on their way to defend Palanthus. Sturm had triumphed, but his victory was not cause for celebration. His appointment as third in command meant that Sturm would be serving under Derek, who had been appointed commander-in-chief. To make matters worse, Lord Alfred Markennan, one of Derek's followers, was second in command. Clearly, trouble lay ahead for Storm. The battle for Polanthus would be a bitter one, determining control of the entire northern part of Salamnia. The leaders soon agreed upon their strategy. The city walls would be defended by the Polanthian army. The Salamnic knights themselves would occupy the high Clarist's tower that stood blocking the pass through the Vingard Mountains. Finally, the knights set sail for Polanthus. Storm, clasping the star jewel in his hand, felt sure that Alhanna was with him somehow. When the ships had disappeared over the horizon, Lord Gunthar made his way back to his castle, only to find that he had visitors, Fizban and Tasselhoff. Fizban explained that they had come to retrieve the dragon orb and used magic to compel the aging knight to cooperate. Gunthar told them the orb was being safeguarded by the gnomes of Mount Nevermind, ancient allies of the Knights of Salamnia. Tass and Fizban went straight there and were led to the orb, which the scientific-minded gnomes had understudied. It had never occurred to them that the orb might be magic. But Fizban instantly took control of it. Its swirling colors went black, and it shrank to the size of a pea. Fizban took a small black bag out of his pocket and placed the orb inside.
"And now,"
said Fizban,
"the orb must be taken before the Council of Whitestone."
The old maid sighed.
"Much will depend on the decisions a few make. Perhaps the fate of the world."
"What do you mean?" Tass asked.
You don't understand, my boy."
The maid sat down, leaning against a wall. Shaking his head, he continued.
I concentrated my will on the orb, Tass. Or not to control dragons. Though I looked into the future. I saw two roads stretching before us. If we take the easiest, it will appear best at the beginning. But darkness will fall at the end, never to be lifted. The other road will be difficult to travel. It could cost the lives of some we love, dear boy. Worse, it might cost others their very souls. But only through these great sacrifices will we find hope."
Fizban closed his eyes.
"Alas, the decisions are not in my hands. That will be up to others."
"I see," said the kender. "Important people, I suppose?" Suddenly a lump formed in Tass's throat. This adventure was turning out all wrong. Where was Tanis, and dear old Caramon, and pretty Tika, and Flint? He might die. He might be dead right now. We've gotten scattered somehow, thought the unhappy kender, and everything's all wrong. His face in his hands, Tass began to cry.
"Oh, that's right, Kenderkin,"
said Fizban.
"Important people."
When Tass and Fizban arrived in Sandcrest 1 month later, the Council of Whitestone was just about to begin. Gathered in the sacred glade of the Whitestone were representatives of all the races on Kryn. Gunthar had hoped this meeting would unite all the races in their fight against the dragon armies, but from the beginning there was trouble. Elistan had succeeded in convincing the elves to attend, but they seemed more suspicious of the humans than they were of the dragon high lords. Nevertheless, Elistan had told Gunthar there was still hope, that it was written in the discs of Mishakal that evil, by its very nature, would always turn in upon itself, and so good would win out in the end. Gunthar wished he could believe it. In the center of the glade stood the white stone itself, which was so holy no one dared touch it. Next to it stood the dragon orb, grown to its full size, glowing with an eerie light. Before Gunthar had finished his welcoming speech, the elves rose to deliver an ultimatum. The knights must return the dragon orb to them, or the elves would declare war on the humans. The knights refused. War seemed only seconds away. Tasselhoff looked around desperately. Maybe Fizban could do something. But the old mage was still asleep. Tass shook him. "Please wake up. Do something." At that moment, He heard warriors on all sides drawing their weapons. Something broke within Tasselhoff. "Stop this!" he heard himself yell. "Stop this right now and listen to me!" Suddenly he saw, to his astonishment, that everyone had stopped talking and was staring at him. Now that he had his audience, Tass realized he didn't have any idea what to say to all of these important people. Flipping his tassel of brown hair over his shoulder, the Kender came to stand right in front of the dragon orb. Looking up, he could see the white stone towering over him, and out of the corner of his eye, he thought he saw Fizban grinning from under his hat. Then Tasselhoff knew what he had to do. He began to shake with fear. He, Tasselhoff Burfoot, who'd never been afraid of anything in his life. But Tass was resolute. He had to keep them talking, keep them from guessing what he planned, while he kept edging closer and closer to the dragon orb.
"You've never taken us, Kender, very seriously, you know," Tass began, his voice shrill. "And I can't say I blame you much. We are probably too curious for our own good. But I ask you, how are you going to find out anything if you're not curious? But one thing the Kender know is..."
Tasselhoff broke into a run. Quick and lithe as a mouse, he slipped easily through the hands that tried to catch him, reaching the dragon orb within a matter of seconds. Faces blurred around him, mouths opened, shrieking and yelling at him. But they were too late. In one swift, smooth movement, Tasselhoff hurled the dragon orb at the huge, gleaming white stone. The round, gleaming crystal hung suspended in the air for long, long seconds. Then it struck the rock and shattered, bursting into a thousand sparkling pieces. There was intense, awful silence.
"We know," Tass said in a small voice that dropped into the dreadful silence like a tiny drop of rain. "We should be fighting dragons, not each other."
Lord Gunthar and the speaker both lunged at Tass, grabbing him.
"You have shattered our hope and brought death upon us all."
The speaker's fingers bit into Tass's flesh. Porthos loomed above the cowering Kender, his sword glistening in his hand.
"And for that, he will die."
No, said a sleepy voice. "No one's going to die." He quit waving the sword around, Porthos.
Tass saw Fizban tottering toward him. Elves and humans made way for him to pass, as if compelled to do so by an unseen force.
"That Kender," he said, "has more brains beneath that ridiculous topknot of his than the lot of you have put together. Do you know what would have happened if he hadn't done what he did? Well, I'll tell you. Just let me find a seat here."
Fizban peered around vaguely.
"Ah, yes, there."
The old man toddled over and sat down on the ground, leaning his back against the sacred white stone. The assembled knights gasped in horror. Gunthar leaped to his feet. Fizban slowly turned his head to regard the furious knight.
"One more word and I'll make your mustaches fall off. Now sit down, shut up. Where was I? Oh, yes. One of you would have won the orb, of course. And you would have taken it, either to keep it safe or to save the world. And yes, it is capable of saving the world, but only if you know how to use it. Few there are with the power to gain mastery over it. Oh, no, few indeed. And none who sit here. Oh, you would have hurled yourselves upon disaster. As for hope being shattered, I tell you, hope was lost for a time. But now it has been newborn."
A sudden gust of wind caught the old mage's hat, blowing it away from him. Fizban crawled forward to pick it up. Just as the mage leaned over, the sun broke through the clouds. There was a flash of silver, followed by a splintering, deafening crack. The white stone had been split asunder. The old magician lay sprawled at its base, his hat clutched in his hand. Above him, piercing the rock where he had been sitting, was a long weapon made of gleaming silver. It had been thrown by the silver arm of a black man who walked over to stand beside it. Accompanying him were an elven woman, an old white-bearded dwarf, and Elistan. The black man lifted the weapon from the splintered remains of the rock, then thrust it deep into the ground. It stood straight and shining amid the broken pieces of the dragon orb.
"I am Theros Ironfeld, with the silver arm given me by the gods.
I have forged the weapon as legend foretold. And this I bring to all the people of Kryn, that we may join together and defeat the great evil that threatens to engulf us in darkness forever. I bring you the Dragonlance.
Lorana stared out the window of Lord Gunthar's castle, where she, Elistan, Flint, and Tasselhoff were staying as guests. After Theros' dramatic presentation of the Dragonlance, the Council of Whitestone had voted unanimously to make more of these weapons and unite all races in the fight against the dragon armies. "My work here is done, Elistan," she said. "I am free to leave now."
"True," Elistan agreed slowly. "But where will you go?"
"To the last place I saw Tanis. Sylvan Esti."
"But Lorana, that was only a dream."
The Oak Princess shuddered. "It was more than a dream. He is alive. And I must find him." At that moment, Lord Gunthar suddenly entered the room.
"Storm has been vindicated, thanks to your testimony,"
he announced jubilantly.
"Lorana, I want you to go to Palanthas. You can teach the knights there to use the dragon lances, and you will take with you a writ of vindication, fully restoring Sturm's honor. That will strike the death's blow to Derek's ambition."
"Why me?" Lorana asked. "Anyone can carry the writ to Sturm."
"Lady, I dare not trust any of the knights with this. And think what would happen to Sturm and to the knights if Derek seized control."
Lorana stared at him for a moment, then bowed her head in submission. As the time of Lorana's departure drew nearer, she began to dream nightly of Tanis. Her heart ached for him. She saw him holding that human woman with the dark, curly hair and flashing brown eyes. Elistan could offer her little comfort. A messenger had arrived from the elves, requesting the cleric's presence, and there was little time for farewells. Soon Elistan and his escort, Lord Alfred's son, a solemn, serious young man named Douglas, began their journey back to Urgoth. Lorana had never felt so alone as she bid her mentor goodbye. Tasselhoff faced a sad parting as well. Fizban and the gnome who had helped them collect the broken fragments of the dragon orb were now taking the pieces back to Mount Nevermind for scientific study. Tasselhoff had been offered the choice of going with Fizban or accompanying Lorana and Flint on their journey to Palanthas. The Kender knew two such innocents as the elf maid and the dwarf could not survive without him. But it was hard leaving his old friend.
"Well, Fizban, I guess this is goodbye," he said, extending his small hand to the mage. "I'm going with Lorana. We're taking the lances, and... oh, I don't think I'm supposed to be telling anyone."
"Oh, don't worry. Mum's the word. You'll love Palanthas. Beautiful city. Give Sturm my regards. Oh, and Tasselhoff, you did the right thing, my boy."
"I did? I wondered. What you said, the dark path? Did I..."
Fizban's face grew grave as he gripped Taz firmly.
"I'm afraid so. But you have the courage to walk it."
"I hope so. Well, goodbye. I'll be back when the war's over."
"Oh, I probably won't be here,"
said Fizban, shaking his head.
"But don't worry. We'll meet again."
Someone else said goodbye to the old magician, too, although not under quite the same circumstances. Elistan was pacing the shore of Sandcrest, waiting for the boat that would take him to Urgoth. Suddenly, he looked up to see the old, befuddled magician.
"Oh, I say," said the mage, "haven't we met?"
For a moment, Elistan could not speak. His face turned deathly white. Finally, he answered.
"Indeed we have, sir. I did not realize it before now. Though we were but lately introduced, I feel that I have known you for a long, long time.
Indeed. Well, have a pleasant journey and a safe one. Farewell.
Leaning on his staff, the old man toddled on past them. Suddenly he turned around.
By the way, the name's Fizban.
I'll remember,
Elistan said gravely, bowing.
Fizban.
Across the Ancelon continent, in the port of Flotsam, Caramon and Tanis, dressed in the stolen armor of Dragon Army officers, were booking passage to Palanthas. The vessel's name was the Perishon, and its captain was a woman, an erstwhile pirate named Makesta Carthon. Her crew was a ragtag assortment of rough men and minotaurs, except for one, the helmsman. He was a deaf-mute, a man of seeming middle age with youthful blue eyes and the hands of a young man. The captain called him Barum. Tanis knew he'd seen the man before, but he couldn't place him. Tanis sent Caramon back to rejoin the others at the inn on the outskirts of town where they were holed up. Then he went off to buy supplies for their journey. The town was crawling with Draconians. This surprised Tanis, for he'd been told the Dragon Army had little interest in Flotsam. As he walked down the street, Tanis was set upon by an elf who took him for a real dragon officer. The elf had lost his family to the dragon armies and wanted revenge. Just as he was about to stab Tanis to death with his dagger, the elf cried out in pain as a sword pierced his heart. Tanis looked up at his rescuer, only to find that it was a dragon high lord who had saved his life. But the biggest surprise came when the high lord took off his dragon mask. It was Kitiara. Seeing him dressed in blue dragon armor, Kitiara immediately assumed Tanis had seen the futility of resisting the Dark Queen and had joined the Dragon Army. Tanis played along, not wanting to endanger himself or his friends. Smiling her crooked smile, she took him back to her lodgings. But there, as Kit drew closer to him, kissing him, promising him paradise, Tanis forgot his friends, forgot his quest, forgot everything. Everything except the fire inside him. He knew only one way to quench it.
And now,
Kitiara murmured sleepily, lying in Tanis's arms.
Tell me about my little brothers. The last I saw them, you were escaping from Tarsus with that elf woman.
That was you, Tanis said, remembering the blue dragons.
Of course. How did you get into the army?
How indeed, thought Tanis frantically. We were captured in Sylvanesti. One of the officers convinced me I was a fool to fight the Dark Queen. And my little brothers? We were separated.
A pity. I'd like to see them again. Caramon must be a giant by now. And Raislin? Still wearing the red robes?
Yeah, I guess.
That won't last long. Raist is like me. He craves power.
What about you? Tanis interrupted quickly. What are you doing here? The fighting's north.
Why, I'm here for the same reason you are. Searching for the green gemstone man, of course.
I've seen him, Tanis murmured, more to himself than to Kitiara, the helmsman of the Perishon. He was the same man Tanis had seen in Paxtharkus, escaping with poor Aben, the man with the green gemstone embedded in his chest. Kitiara grasped his arm.
You found him? Where, Tanis?
Tanis quickly shook his head. I'm not sure it was him. We were just given a rough description.
We had reports he was sighted in Flotsam, Kitiara said. That's why the Dark Queen sent me here. He's the key, Tanis. Find him and no force on Kryn can stop us.
Why? What's he got that's so essential to our side winning this war?
Who knows? We were just told that finding this man would end the war in one stroke.
Just think, Tanis. If we found him, you and I would have all of Kryn at our feet. The Dark Queen would reward us beyond anything we ever dreamed. You and I, together always, Tanis. Let's go find him now. Her words echoed in his mind. The two of them, together, forever. Ending the war ruling Kryn. This is the woman I've dreamed of for so long. Kitiara, so beautiful, so desirable.
No,
Tanis said harshly. Then,
no,
he said more gently. Reaching out, he pulled her back near him. Tomorrow will do. If it was him, he isn't going anywhere. I know. As he kissed her passionately, making her forget, Tanis could hear the blood sea of Istar crashing on the shore. One thing stood between the dragon armies and victory in Salamnia, the Tower of the High Clerist. The tower protected Palanthas, capital city of Salamnia, and the harbor known as the Gates of Paladine. Let the tower fall, and Palanthas, indeed all of the north, would belong to the dragon armies. But the Dragon High Lord was not in camp this day. She was gone on secret business to the east. Her troops of draconians, goblins, hobgoblins, ogres, and humans sat around their campfires, staring at the tower, longing to attack. The tower was defended by the Knights of Salamnia, who had marched out from Palanthas only a few weeks ago. Before she left, the High Lord had told her troops,
"We've cut off their supplies. Let them sit in their tower and starve. Sooner or later, their stomachs will cause them to make a mistake. When they do, be ready."
Young Baccarus, her handsome second-in-command, had wanted to take the tower with dragons, but Kitiara was wary. She had heard of the discovery of the Dragonlances. She sailed off on the back of her dragon, Sky, hoping to find the green gemstone man and make the taking of the tower unnecessary. And so, the dragon armies waited, warm and comfortable around their fires, while the knights in their tower starved. But far worse than the lack of food was the bitter dissension within their own ranks. The young knights under Stern Brightblade's command had grown to revere their leader for his honesty and integrity. But it was a costly victory, and caused Sturm a great deal of suffering at Derek's hands. Derek's threatening manner had also alienated the people of Palanthas. It was only through Sturm's patient negotiations that the knights received any supplies at all. The situation did not improve when the knights reached the High Clerist's tower. Soon, the tower itself became an armed camp. The majority, who favored Derek, now openly opposed by those favoring Gunthar, led by Sturm. Too late, Lord Alfred realized the danger. He could see now that Derek Crown Guard was going insane. Derek's lust for power grew daily, eating away at him and depriving him of his reason. But Lord Alfred also knew it could take months to strip Derek of his rank. Then Lorana and her companions arrived, reaching the tower just before a gigantic snowstorm closed the pass completely, shutting off all access to Palanthas. Her offer to teach the knights how to use the dragon lances met with howls of derision from Derek and his followers. The lances were unwieldy, clumsy, they said. And so the dragon lances lay in the courtyard of the tower, unused, forgotten, their bright silver buried beneath the snow. And the news they brought of Sturm's vindication struck this dry and crackling forest like a bolt of lightning. It completely severed Derek's tenuous hold on sanity. Sturm and Flint walked the battlements one night, reminiscing.
A well of pure silver, shining like a jewel in the heart of the Dragon Mountain,
Flint said, awe in his voice.
And it was from that silver that Theros forged the dragon lances.
I should have liked above all things to have seen Yuma's tomb, Sturm said quietly.
When this is finished, Sturm, we'll go there together, you and Tanis and I, and the Kenda too.
Sturm smiled absently, his thoughts far away. If we can just hold out until the supply lines can be established. We've got enough manpower. That's why the dragon armies haven't attacked.
There is another way,
came a voice. Sturm and Flint turned. The torchlight fell on a gaunt face, and Sturm's expression hardened. What way is that, Lord Derek? Derek stared at Sturm.
By one heroic act, I will have the knights in my palm, and you and Gunthar will be finished. Tomorrow we take the field. No more skulking in this miserable rock prison. by tomorrow night, my name will be legend.
Derek, Sturm said softly, you're mad. There are thousands of them. They'll cut you to ribbons.
Oh, yes, that's what you'd like to see, isn't it? Derek sneered. Be ready at dawn, Bright Blade.
The High Clerist's Tower was an odd piece of architecture, with its three great doors breaching the outer wall. Each door opened into a courtyard with a portcullis at the far end. The portcullises led to three hallways which met in the heart of the tower itself.
Might as well invite the enemy inside for tea,
Flint had grumbled when he first saw it. Now no one ever entered the High Tower. To the knights, it was sacred. But of course, nothing was inviolate to Tasselhoff. Driven by his insatiable curiosity and his gnawing hunger, the Kender slipped through the portcullis. Inside, in a huge hallway, strange columns ranged along either side, like jagged teeth. Behind them were small alcoves. Tass came to a second portcullis already raised, then a second hallway, narrower than the first, with the same strange tooth-like columns. Why build a tower so easy to enter? Tass wondered. At the end of the second hallway, he found a third portcullis, made of two halves, which slid together to join in the center. Oddest of all, there was a large hole cut right through the middle of the doors. Crawling through this hole, Tass found himself in a great, wide, circular room, empty except for a dust-covered object that resembled an ancient fountain, standing squarely in the center. This was the heart of the tower. This was the sacred place. This was what all the fuss was about. Nothing. Tass walked around a bit, shining his torchlight here and there. Finally, the disgruntled Kender went to examine the fountain in the center of the room before leaving. As Tass drew closer, he saw it wasn't a fountain at all, but the dust was so thick he couldn't figure it out. It was about as tall as the Kender, about 4 feet. The round top was supported on a slender three-legged stand. Tass inspected it closely. Then he took a deep breath and blew as hard as he could. Oh, no, he groaned. Another dragon orb. Now what do I do?
The next morning, Sturm informed Derek that neither he nor the knights under his command would ride with Derek on his suicidal mission. They would stay behind instead and defend the tower. Swearing to have Sturm's head, Derek rode out with his knights to do battle. According to the measure, even though he knew that Derek was now completely insane, Lord Alfred had no choice but to ride with him. By the end of the day, every last one of the knights who rode with Derek had been slaughtered. Meanwhile, Tasselhoff told Lorana and Sturm about his discovery. He showed the orb to Lorana and read her the writing inside it, using his glasses of true seeing. Ironically, that afternoon a messenger arrived from Palanthus, saying that the road was now open and supplies were on their way. Had Derek waited just one more day, the attack would have been unnecessary. That night, Baccharus, the Dragon Army commander, rode alone and unarmed to the gates of the tower. He dumped the bodies of Lord Alfred and Derek Crown Guard there and demanded that the knights surrender. Baccharus knew the knights were forbidden by their laws to attack an unarmed man. But Lorana was not bound by the measure. Furious, she sent an arrow flying. It hit Baccharus in the right arm, crippling him. Crying out in pain, he swore revenge on the elf maid and the knights, then rode away.
The dragon armies marched upon the tower at dawn. The young knights, the 100 or so that were left, stood silently on the battlements, watching as the vast army crawled across the land like devouring insects. Flint peered out from a crack in the wall.
At least I'll die on dry land, he muttered.
Sturm smiled slightly, stroking his mustaches. His eyes went to the east. As he thought about dying, he looked upon the land where he'd been born. A home he had barely known, a father he barely remembered, a country that had driven his family into exile. He was about to give his life to defend that country. Why? Why didn't he just leave and go back to Palanthus? All of his life, Sturm had followed the code and the measure, the book of rules which guided the lives of every Salamnic knight. The code, my honor is my life, was all he had left. The measure was gone. It had failed. Rigid, inflexible, the measure had encased the knights in steel heavier than armor. The knights, isolated, fighting to survive, had clung to the measure in despair, not realizing that it was an anchor, weighing them down. Why was I different? Sturm wondered. But he knew, even as he listened to the dwarf grumble. It was because of the dwarf, the kender, the mage, the half-elf. They had taught him to see the world through other eyes, smaller eyes, slanted eyes, even hourglass eyes. Knights like Derek saw the world in stark, black and white. Sturm had seen the world in all its radiant colors, in all its bleak grayness. It's time, he said to Flint. The two descended from the high lookout point. With shrieks and yells, the blaring of horns, and crashing of shield and sword, the dragon armies struck the tower of the High Clarist as the sun's brittle light filled the sky. By nightfall, the flag still flew. The tower stood, but half its defenders were dead. The dragon armies withdrew to rest and wait for the morrow. Sturm paced the battlements, his body aching with weariness. Yet every time he tried to rest, his brain seemed on fire. Sturm's thoughts were dark and tormented, thoughts of defeat, of dying ignobly, without honor, tortured memories of the dream, seeing his body hacked and mutilated by the foul creatures camped beyond. Would the dream come true? Would he falter at the end, unable to conquer fear? 2 days, Sturm thought. It would take 2 days for reinforcements from Palanthas to reach the tower, if the messenger could convince them to come. Sturm thought of his friends. Their deaths would be horrible if they were captured. The eastern sky was brightening when the knights were wakened by the blaring of horns. Hastily they rose, grabbed their weapons, and stood to the walls, peering out across the dark land. The dragon armies were retreating. Sturm watched, puzzled. The armies moved back just over the horizon. Some of the younger knights began to cheer. "Keep quiet," Sturm commanded harshly. Their shouts grated on his raw nerves. Lorana glanced at him in astonishment. His eyes narrowed as he leaned forward, staring eastward. I pray I am wrong, he said in a broken voice. Flint came to join them, clambering up on a huge slab of broken stone to see over the edge of the wall. Tass woke, yawning. When's breakfast? Seeing them, the kinder grew serious. What is it? Climbing up to stand beside Flint, he saw the sun burning on the horizon. What are we looking at?
Nothing,
Flint grumbled. Then why are we looking? The kender caught his breath with a sharp gulp as he saw what none of the others could yet see. Dragons! Blue dragons! I thought as much, Sturm said softly. The dragon fear. That's why they pulled the armies back. The humans fighting among them could not withstand it. How many dragons? 3, answered Lorana. I can see them now. She dragged Sturm back away from the wall. Listen, Sturm. There's an orb here, in the tower. Last night, in my dream, I saw dragons flying down stone halls. I know how the orb works. I know how to kill the dragons. Quickly, she explained her plan. The knight looked at her, then toward the dragons speeding out of the ever-brightening east. Very well. Flint, you and Tass go down and gather the men together in the courtyard. Hurry! Lorana's face glowed. You come too, Sturm. I'll explain this to the men, then you can arrange the battle disposition. Sturm gazed at her, his eyes clear. You're in command, Lorana. What? The fear and pain in her heart made her gasp. You need time. I'll get it for you. He picked up a bow and a quiver of arrows. No, Sturm. Don't do this to yourself. Sturm took her face in his hands and kissed her gently. Farewell, elf maid. Your light will shine in this world. It is time for mine to darken. Don't grieve. Don't cry. Once in Darken Wood, the forest master told us not to mourn those who have fulfilled their destiny. Mine is fulfilled. Tell Tanis. No, he added with a slight smile. He will know what was in my heart. Lorana looked up as Sturm climbed the narrow stairs that led to a high wall near the central tower. With a choked sob, she lowered her gaze to the courtyard where the knights waited. Then she walked toward them, her golden hair shimmering in the morning light. The cold, brittle sun stained the sky blood red as Sturm reached the top of the wall. Looking east, he saw the blue dragons. On the back of the lead dragon sat a High Lord in full armor. Raising his sword in salute to Lorana and the others, Sturm walked to the center of the wall, a small figure poised halfway between land and sky. Sheathing his sword, Sturm fitted an arrow to his bow and took careful aim at the lead dragon. The arrow bounced off the dragon's blue scales, but the dragon reared in pain. Quickly, Sturm fired again. The arrow tore into a wing, and the dragon shrieked in rage. The knight had accomplished what he set out to do, forced them to fight him. Now, Sturm could see the High Lord, spear in hand, rising in the saddle. Built like a chariot, the saddle could accommodate its rider in a standing position for battle. Picking up his sword and shield, Sturm watched as the dragon flew closer, its red eyes flaring, its white teeth gleaming. Sturm heard trumpet calls, the same ones he had heard in the dream. Fear knotted his stomach. His skin grew cold. The dragon fear was overwhelming him. Escape, his brain screamed. No, Sturm got hold of himself. Everything else was gone. His ideals, his hopes, his dreams. The knighthood was collapsing. The measure had been found wanting. Everything in his life was meaningless. His death must not be so. He would buy Lorana time, buy it with his life, since that was all he had to give. In the courtyard, the knights were surging past Lorana into the tower, hope dawning in their hearts. But Lorana could not leave that gleaming, solitary figure standing alone on the wall. Raising his sword in the air, Sturm gave the knight's salute to an enemy. To his surprise, the High Lord returned it with grave dignity. Then the dragon dove, its horrifying scream filling his head with pain. Sturm staggered dizzily, but managed to stay on his feet as he slashed out with his sword. The ancient blade struck the dragon's left nostril. Black blood spurted into the air, but the blow was costly, throwing Sturm off balance. Seizing the moment, the High Lord raised his spear, thrusting it deep, piercing through armor, flesh, and bone. Sturm's sun shattered. Lorana saw the spear strike, and her world stopped turning. As she watched in horror, a glittering object fell slowly from the top of the wall into the courtyard. Sturm's sword. Then the High Lord jerked the spear free, and Sturm's body crumpled where he stood, a dark mass against the sun. The dragon roared in rage, and a bolt of lightning streaked from its mouth, striking the tower. The stone burst apart. Horns blared as the High Lord signaled the dragon armies to attack. Lorana hesitated an instant, bidding a silent farewell to the spirit of the night, then ran forward and grabbed Sturm's sword, raising it defiantly in the air. Suliasi Arath, she cried in Elven, a voice ringing a challenge above the sounds of destruction. The dragon shrieked in cruel enjoyment of the kill. Lorana ran inside the tower. Get back, she shouted. Stay behind the pillars. Lorana ran until she reached the chamber of the dragon orb. She saw a faint red mist swirling with myriad colors in it. Tass stood by the orb, his magical glasses perched upon his small nose. Lorana, he begged, don't do this. I've read if you fail to control the orb, it will take control of you. Her resolve was strong. Just tell me what I need to do. Put your hands on the orb and... Oh, no, wait, Lorana! It was too late. Lorana's hands were already on the orb. Lorana, concentrate. Clear your mind of everything except bending the orb to your will. Lorana! If she heard him, she made no response, and Tass realized she was already caught up in the battle for control of the orb. In agony he watched her, longing to help, yet knowing that he did not dare to do anything. No, she moaned, and it seemed as if she were trying desperately to pull her hands away. But the orb held them fast. Lorana's body gave a convulsive shudder. Tass saw her drop to her knees, her hands still holding fast to the orb. Then Lorana shook her head angrily. Muttering unfamiliar words in Elven, she fought to stand, using the orb to drag herself up. The orb flared a final time, becoming many colors and none. Then a bright, beaming, pure white light poured from the orb. Lorana stood tall before it, her face relaxed. She smiled, and then she collapsed unconscious to the floor. Outside, the dragons were reducing the stone walls to rubble. The High Lord supervised the destruction. All was going well when the daylight was pierced by a pure white light beaming out from the tower. Two of the dragons heard the silent call of the orb and no longer obeyed their rider's commands. The light touched the front ranks of the dragon armies, and the human commanders stared as their army of draconians went mad. In minutes, an organized, well-planned attack had turned into mass confusion as 1,000 draconians dashed off in every direction, shrieking. The High Lord shouted in vain fury as the army broke and ran, and as the two dragons in the courtyard flew inexorably toward the source of the mysterious white light. The first dragon, a small blue one, sped inside the entryway, its rider ducking just in time to avoid having his head taken off by the wall. Obeying the call of the orb, the blue dragon flew easily through the wide stone halls, the tips of its wings just barely brushing the sides. Flint watched it coming. Both he and the knight shrank back, overcome by dragon fear. But the dragon sped on, seeking only one thing. Its head glided under the strange portcullis. Acting instinctively, knowing only that the dragon must not reach the orb, Flint released the mechanism. The portcullis closed around the dragon's neck, holding it fast. The dragon's head was trapped within the small chamber. Its body lay helpless before the knights, who stood with dragon lances ready. Tass, who was trying to revive Lorana in the chamber of the orb, found himself staring into two flaming eyes. Lightning crackled from the dragon's throat, knocking the Kenda flag. Tass waited for the next bolt, but it never came. Instead, the most horrible scream imaginable reverberated through the chamber as the knights lunged out of their hiding places and drove the silver dragon lances into the writhing body of the trapped dragon. The Kenda buried his head in his hands and wept. Then he felt a gentle hand touch him.
Lorana, he raised his head. I know I shouldn't care what they do to the dragon, but I can't stand it.
Lorana gathered him close.
Don't be ashamed, Tass.
Be thankful you can feel pity and horror at the death of an enemy.
The day we cease to care, even for our enemies, is the day we have lost this battle.
The knights called out another warning as a second dragon entered the tower in response to the call of the orb.
Come, Tass, Lorana cried. Let's get out of here.
Dragging Tass to his feet, she ran toward a small door, yanking it open just as the dragon's head burst into the room. Tass could see the dragon's flaring eyes, mad with rage at the sounds of its dying mate, knowing too late that it had flown into the same trap. The large blue dragon sucked in its breath. The double steel doors dropped in front of it, but only halfway.
Lorana, the door stuck, Tass shouted. The dragon orb! Come on!
Lorana yanked at the Kenda's hand. Lightning flashed, and Tass turned and fled, hearing the room behind him explode into flame. Rock and stone filled the chamber. The white light of the dragon orb was buried in the debris as the tower of the High Clerist collapsed on top of it. Lorana and Tass kept going, heading for the bright daylight. Then the ground was still. Pausing a moment to catch their breath, Tass and Lorana looked behind them. The end of the passage was completely blocked, choked by debris.
What about the dragon orb?
Tass gasped, taking in Lorana's face in the daylight. The only color she had was in her eyes, and they seemed disturbingly large, shadowed by purple smudges.
It's better destroyed. I could never use it again, she whispered. I nearly died using it this time. But I remembered Sturm, how he faced his death. If I gave in, his death would have been meaningless. I couldn't let that happen.
Tass's voice quivered.
Sturm? Sturm's dead?
Lorana looked at him pityingly.
I'm sorry, Tass. I didn't realize you didn't know. He died fighting the Dragon High Lord.
Tass bowed his head, then raised it again quickly, as another explosion shook what remained of the fortress.
The Dragon armies,
Lorana murmured, her hand going to the hilt of Sturm's sword, which was now buckled around her slender waist.
Go find Flint.
Lorana emerged into the courtyard, blinking in the bright light, almost surprised to see it was still day. The tall tower of the High Clarist was now just a heap of rubble in the center of the courtyard. The outer walls still stood, although breached in places, their stone blackened by the dragon's fire. What happened to the dragon armies? Lorana wondered. Then she saw a flash of sunlight shining on armor on the top of the wall. Sturm. She climbed up and stared out across the plain, expecting to see the black tide of the army surging forward. But the plain was empty. What could it mean? Putting her hand out, she brushed back the wind-blown hair to look once more upon the face of her friend. For the first time since she'd met him, Lorana saw peace in Sturm's eyes. Lifting his cold hand, she pressed it to her cheek. Sleep, dear friend, and let not your sleep be troubled by dragons. Then she saw a bright sparkle in the blood-stained snow. An elven star jewel. But before Lorana could wonder at how it came to be here, a dark shadow fell over her. An enormous blue dragon landed on the wall behind her, its great claws crumbling stones as it scrabbled for a hold. On the dragon's back, a High Lord gazed at Lorana with cold, stern eyes behind the hideous helm. Lorana stepped backward as the dragon fear overcame her. The lance slipped from her hand, and she dropped the jewel into the snow. The dragon lance! Scrambling for it in the blood-wet snow, Lorana's fingers closed over its wooden shaft. She started to rise, intending to plunge it into the dragon's neck, but a black boot slammed down upon the lance, narrowly missing her hand. The High Lord faced the elf maid who knelt in the snow, and removed the booted foot from the dragon lance.
He was my friend, too. I knew the moment I killed him.
Lorana stared up at the High Lord. I don't believe you. Calmly, the Dragon High Lord removed her mask.
I think you have heard of me, Lorlanthalassa. That is your name, isn't it?
Lorana nodded dumbly, rising to her feet. The Dragon High Lord smiled, a charming, crooked smile.
And my name is...
Kitiara, I know you from the dream.
Oh, yes. Tanis told me about the dream. I guess you all shared it.
He thought you might have. She glanced down at the body of Sturm, lying at her feet.
Odd, isn't it? The way Sturm's death came true. And Tanis said the dream came true for him as well. The part where I saved his life.
Lorana began to tremble.
You've seen Tanis? I left him in Flotsam 2 days ago. He was going to keep an eye on things for me while I was gone.
Kitiara's cold, calm words drove through Lorana's soul like the High Lord's spear had driven through Sturm's flesh.
She's lying, Lorana thought desperately.
But she knew with despairing certainty that, though Kitiara might lie when she chose, she was not lying now. Kitiara bent down, picking up the weapon Lorana had dropped and studying it with interest.
So this is the famed Dragonlance.
Swallowing her grief, Lorana forced herself to speak in a steady voice.
Yes. If you want to see what it's capable of, go see what's left of your dragons.
Kitiara glanced down into the courtyard briefly.
It was not these that lured my dragons into your trap, nor scattered my army to the four winds. Savor your victory now, elf maid, for it will be short-lived.
Grasping the dragon lance in her hand, Kitiara added,
It will take at least 3 days to rebuild the army. I give you that time to prepare a ceremony befitting him.
We will bury our own dead, Lorana said proudly. We ask you for nothing. Moving to stand protectively between Sturm's body and the Dragon High Lord, Lorana looked into the brown eyes.
What will you tell Tanis? Nothing. Nothing at all.
Turning, Kitiara walked back to where Skye sat waiting. The sun glinted off the lance, which she held in her hand.
Take the dragon lance, Lorana said. Much good it will do you.
Laughing scornfully, Kitiara swung herself onto the dragon.
Farewell, Lorlanthalassa.
Lifting the dragon lance in the air, Kitiara commanded Skye to fly. The huge blue dragon spread his wings, rising into the air. Guiding him skillfully, Kitiara flew just above Lurana. Sunlight flashed from the point of the Dragonlance. Then it fell from the Dragon High Lord's gloved hand. Clattering on the stones, it landed at Lurana's feet.
"Keep it," Kitiara called. "You're going to need it."
The blue dragon lifted his wings and soared into the sky. At Sturm's funeral, Lurana spoke to the assembled knights. "You expect a noble speech," she said, "honoring the heroic deeds of these men who have died. Well, you won't get it from me. These men, who should have been united in a brotherhood forged when Kryn was young, died in bitter discord, brought about by pride, ambition, and greed. Your eyes turned to Derek Crownguard, but he was not totally to blame. All of you who took sides in his reckless bid for power are to blame." A few knights lowered their heads, some paled with shame and anger. Lurana choked on her tears. Then she felt Flint's hand slip into hers and found strength to continue. "Only one man here among you lived the code every day of his life, and for most of those days, he was not a knight. Or rather, he was a knight where it meant the most, in spirit, in heart, not in some official list." Reaching behind her, Lurana took the blood-stained dragon lance from the altar and raised it high over her head. The knights stared at her in wonder. Her beauty blessed them like the beauty of a dawning spring day. "Tomorrow I will go to Palanthus. I will take this lance and the head of a dragon. I will dump that sinister bloody head upon the steps of their magnificent palace and make them listen to me. And when they have listened, I will go to Sancrist and to Urgoth and to every other place on Kryn where people refuse to lay down their petty hatreds and join together. For until we conquer the evils within ourselves, as this man did, we can never conquer the great evil that threatens to engulf us." Lurana raised her hands and her eyes to heaven. "Paladine! We come to you, Paladine, escorting the souls of these noble knights who died in the High Clarist Tower. Give us, who are left behind in this war-torn world, the same nobility of spirit that graces this man's death." She closed her eyes as tears spilled unchecked down her cheeks. No longer did she grieve for Sturm. Her sorrow was for herself, for missing him, for having to tell Tanis of his friend's death, for having to live in this world without her noble friend. Slowly she laid the lance on the altar and knelt before it. Behind her, the knights' voices rose in a chant as they slowly left the chamber. Lurana, Flint, and Tasselhoff stood alone beside their friend, their arms around each other, their hearts full. Flint wiped his gnarled and shaking hand across his eyes.
"Friends meet in Riorks," he said.
Fumbling in his pouch, he took out a bit of wood, beautifully carved into the shape of a rose. Gently he laid it upon Sturm's breast, beside Elhanna's star jewel.
"Goodbye, Sturm," Tass said awkwardly, placing a small white feather in the knight's cold hand. "Chrysalin Elivas," Lurana whispered in Elven. "Our love's bond eternal."
"Come, Lurana,"
Flint said gently.
"We must let him go. Riorks waits for him."
Lurana drew back. Silently, without looking back, the three friends climbed the narrow stairs leading from the sepulchre and walked into the chill, stinging sleet of the bitter winter's night. Far away from the frozen land of Salamnia, one other person said goodbye to Sturm Brightblade. Sylvaneste had not changed since Alhanna's return to the Tower of the Stars. The air still smelled of decay. The trees were bent and twisted in unending agony. Misshapen beasts roamed the woods, seeking an end to their tortured existence. In vain, Alhanna watched from her room in the Tower of the Stars for some sign of change. The griffins had come back, but they carried disturbing news of war between the elves and humans. It was a mark of the change in Alhanna these past months that she found this news distressing. Before she met Tanis and the others, she would have accepted war between elves and humans, perhaps even welcomed it. But now she saw that this was work of evil forces in the world. she should return to a people she knew. But she told herself the weather was unsafe for traveling. In reality, she shrank from facing the shock and disbelief of her people when she told them of the destruction of their land. She dreaded facing the tumult of the world beyond Sylvanesti, and she dreaded, even as she longed, to see the human she loved. The knight, whose noble face came to her in her dreams, whose very soul she shared through the Star Jewel. Unknown to him, she shared his agony, and came to learn of the depths of his noble spirit. Her love for him had grown daily, as had her fear of loving him. And so Alhanna continually put off her departure. "I will leave," she told herself, "when I see some sign I may give my people." And so Alhanna continually put off her departure. "I will leave," she told herself, "when I see some sign I may give my people. A sign of hope." Then, one bitter afternoon, Alhanna felt the world stop turning. A shattering pain pierced her body. Sobbing in fear and grief, she clutched the Star Jewel and watched in agony as its light flickered and died.
"So this is my sign!"
she screamed bitterly, holding the darkened jewel in her hand and shaking it at the heavens.
"There is no hope! There is nothing but death and despair!"
That night, she made one final journey out into the land. She threw a thin cape over her shoulders and headed for a grave lying beneath a twisted, tortured tree. In her hand, she held the matching Star Jewel. Throwing herself down upon the ground, Alhanna began to dig frantically. The red moon, Lunatari, crept into the night sky, tinging the silver moon's light with blood. Alhanna stared at the Star Jewel until she could no longer see through her tears. Then she cast it into the hole she had dug. Wiping the tears from her face, she started to fill in the hole. Then she stopped. Her hands trembled. Hesitantly, she reached down and brushed the dirt from a Star Jewel, wondering if her grief had driven her mad. No! From it came a tiny glimmer of light that grew even stronger as she watched.
But he's dead. I know death has claimed him. Yet why this light?
A sudden rustling sound startled her. Alhanna fell back, fearing that the hideously deformed tree above Lorak's grave might be reaching to grasp her in its creaking branches. But as she watched, she saw the limbs of the tree cease their tortured writhing. They hung motionless for an instant, then, with a sigh, turned toward the heavens. The trunk straightened and the bark became smooth and began to glisten in the silver moonlight. Alhanna gasped. Rising unsteadily to her feet, she looked around her. None of the other trees had changed. Only this one, above Lorak's grave. Carefully, Alhanna hung the Star Jewel back in its place over her heart. Then she turned and walked back toward the tower. There was much to be done before she left for Urgoth. The next morning, Alhanna looked out over the forest. Nothing had changed. Nothing would change, she knew, until the elves came back and worked to make a change. Summoning her griffin, she climbed onto its back and began the long flight to Urgoth. Far below, in Sylvanesti, one tree's beautiful green leaves stood out in splendid contrast to the black desolation of the forest around it. It swayed in the winter wind, singing soft music as it spread its limbs to shelter Lorak's grave from the winter's darkness, waiting for spring.
This has been a Random House Audiobooks presentation. We hope you have enjoyed this audio program. Look for the complete trilogy of the Dragonlance Chronicles, available on audio cassette from Random House.